Let's crack open a beer and share some thoughts.
Welcome to Hopinions, and we are back in the studio. Just you and me, mate.
The studio, and yes, it's just Steve and myself, so apologies, we're not on the Mark Johnson show, we're not on the River and Brew show, we're not on the Nick from Beavertown show, it is just
And we're
us.
Not in Manchester.
Yeah.
With Marble, it's just you and I.
In Essex.
Feels like, what, it's been an 8-week journey of doing shows with other people.
Yeah, which has been great fun.
Absolutely, I've loved doing that. And all of the conversations we've had have been brilliant.
They've all been different as well.
Yeah.
You know, from speaking to Jan and Joe in Marble, Nick at Beavertown, Mark coming to my place at work, and then meeting up with River and Brews at Beer Merchants the other week. Been really good.
Yeah.
Really good fun.
But I am looking forward to it just being me and you this
yeah,
weekend, mate.
No, it should be good fun.
Just chatting. And not just that, but we are mere days away from a massive event, aren't we?
Well, when this show goes out, we'll be 2 and a bit days away from me getting married to Michelle.
I know, that's come around so
it
quick,
has.
That so quickly. And can we just get Michelle in here?
This was unscripted, and Michelle was not expecting this.
I just was just saying that we're mere days away from probably the event of the year. Probably the event of the year.
Probably.
The event of the year, which is your wedding.
Invite rescinded.
And I just wanted to take an opportunity. Michelle is actually here. Say hello, Michelle.
Hello.
I just wanted to take an opportunity to say to the both of you, as my good friends as well, that I hope you have a fantastic day on Saturday, and I hope everything is just perfect for you. And I also want to extend that to our listeners as well, and encourage them to tweet the hell out of the pair of you at the weekend.
Oh, thanks, because I haven't got enough to do at the weekend.
And wish you the very best. So that's obviously at NJPO007. And until probably about 2 o'clock on Saturday,
no,
at Ginger Daniels 13.
That's the one.
That may change in time though. So make sure you give these guys your very best wishes.
Oh, thank you.
And in a further unscripted moment as well, I know you guys were very specific about gifts for your wedding, but I have got you a little something that I wanted to present to you kind of live on air, because what do you give to people that are getting married and into their beer?
Okay. Yeah, well, this is completely unscripted.
Whoa.
I wasn't expecting this at all. Oh, the bag's been unzipped.
So this is just a little something from me to you guys, and I hope you enjoy it. Feel free to open it now. I know it's a few days before.
That's all right. Have a little look. What have we got, babe?
Wow, look at that.
So we have a very limited edition run.
Exceptionally limited edition, yeah.
It's a bottle 107 of 123. It's from Wander Beyond Brewing. Iron Born Selected Bourbon Barrel Aged Imperial Stout. From December 2017, part one of the Poseidon series. 16%, 750 millilitres. Thank you very much.
You can have that on Saturday. No, I just wanted to give you something.
It's not a bottle share on Saturday. I've told Tom that already.
It's for you guys to enjoy whenever you want.
Steve,
thank you very much, Steve.
I do just want to say though, again on air, massive thanks to Jan at Marble for sorting those beers out for me, because there is a pair and I've got the other one because I couldn't bear to part with both of them. I needed to keep one of them. But that one's the more limited edition of two. There's less bottles of that one.
So the question is, if Jan could only get you one,
I would have still given it to you. I very much would.
There
have
was
given
a momentary pause.
There was a momentary pause, but
no, thank you
guys,
very much.
Got my heart. I hope everything
so
goes all right Saturday.
Oh, thank you.
It's going to be a fantastic day, and good luck for the future.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you.
So now back to our normally scripted.
Yes. But anyway, thank you again, Steve.
You're very welcome.
Really, really touching.
I do hope you enjoy that.
Wasn't expecting another bottle with wax seal on the top. I'm going to have to cut a finger off to get into.
And there's no way I could let the occasion pass without encouraging our listeners to get involved as well.
Thank you very much. Before we go any further, I'm going to open the first beer.
Yes, let's get into these beers, because we do have 5 beers to get through tonight. They are all big ABV beers as well. And they are all from a listener as well.
The first beer is one of these ones which has the proper open cap.
Yep.
Turns it into space to be a vessel to drink out of, but it's a pig to pour out of.
Yeah, I imagine that makes it quite...
Can you smell that?
I can from here, yeah. That's got some nose on it. So what are you currently decanting into glasses?
And missing the glass because of the can.
It's not me.
It wasn't Steve. So this is the Amundsen Dessert in a Can Pecan and Maple Pie, which comes in at... a very sound 10.5%.
Okay, and this is one of the lowest beers, ABV-wise, that we're going to be drinking.
Yeah, I think there's one beer which is as low.
Yes.
But, my God, has it got some nose on it.
You can literally... I mean, that's got to be, like, almost 2 foot away from me, and I can smell it from here.
Toffee.
Yeah.
Just smells like almost old-school toffee.
As I say, they're from a listener, Will Watkins, who is on Twitter at Dry Your Beers. Now, Will got in touch with us and said, oh, I'd like to send you some beers, guys. This was at a time when we were getting a few requests to send us some homebrews. Yeah. So I thought, brilliant, we're getting some more homebrew. And then these five beers turned up from Will with a little note from him as well, which says, basically, thanks again, both, for all your work and the hours of entertainment. I've sent you a nice collection of five low ABV beers, which it doesn't look like you've had before. Bottoms up, Will. P.S. Couldn't resist one Merc Bomb.
Which we haven't got currently, so there is a Merc Bomb still to come in the other four.
There is. So just want to say, really, thank you to Will for that. I mean, it's such a humbling gesture.
Oh, definitely. And not only has he chosen four beers, which I don't think you and I would have gone for, as in hard to get hold of, but four beers he knows we haven't had.
Yeah, absolutely. So he's been through our Untapped as well to make sure that we've not had these.
Which I'm massively impressed with. But look, without further ado...
Let's drink some beer.
Cheers.
Cheers.
God, don't even need to put it to the nose,
do
you?
Word. I mean, it is overwhelmingly maple syrup, isn't it?
The only thing I can think of now is I wish I had a lump of vanilla ice cream to put this with.
Mm. Or to drizzle it over vanilla ice cream on a Belgian waffle.
You need more sugar with this beer?
I don't know. I've not drunk it yet.
It's actually a little bit bitter on the taste, actually. There is a bit of a dark chocolate bitterness to it, despite that really sweet smell.
There's a lot of sweetness in there as well.
Oh, yeah. Right? Yeah.
And that is thick.
Yeah. I mean, you can see it on the glass. I mean, look at it. It's just hanging.
I've got to say, I'm getting hardly any pecan from that. It's overwhelmingly the sweetness from the maple.
True, but I'm still getting a bit of the pecan with the maple on the aroma as well.
Okay. More so on the aroma?
Yeah.
So, we thought we'd try something different for this show as well, in terms of doing some actual research on the beers.
I know, which is going to be odd.
And breweries, I know.
I mean, I did some research. I decided to have a look to see which beers I'd had from each brewery.
Okay. So what have you had from Amundsen?
So I had the Lush Raspberry and Lime, which I had at the Victoria when they did their Evil Filthy Keg Festival. And I just went very, very fruity and very dry. Give it 3.75.
Okay, well, you must have enjoyed it. I mean, that's a generous rating.
And there was another beer I had the first time I went to Liverpool earlier this year called Run to the Pills, which naturally the only reason I had it was because it run to the hills. Mm-hmm. And again, it was a nice pills, maybe lacked a little bit of sharpness, but it, for me, also lacked a bit of the breadiness, which is quite good. Give that 3.75. And lastly, I think we had this as a bottle share beer, Zombie Juice. Don't know if you remember that one. We had in January. You weren't there, actually.
I wasn't there in January.
January. So it was a New England Pale Ale. So you're probably happy you missed that one.
Yeah.
So I did actually have a look, and I've come across them. I've never been blown away by them, but the beers I've had have been okay. This one, I think, is ticking every box that it says it's going to tick.
It certainly does what it says on the tin. That's without a doubt.
So what do we know about these guys?
Okay, so they're from Oslo in Norway. They're a microbrewery that started as a 5-hectolitre brew pub in 2011. They moved to a 10-hectolitre system in 2013, and then further expansion in 2016 to 42 hectolitres. So that's quite some expansion that they've gone through.
In quite a short space of time as well.
Yeah.
Because the Scandies are quite limited sometimes in where they can sell, what they can do.
Yes.
I know it's different from country to country, but it's still quite hard for them, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Who else is from Norway?
Oh, God, now you know, you put me on the spot.
Because the other one's like Michele's not Norway, is it?
No, that's Denmark.
Right.
I can't think of none that leap to mind at the moment, but they certainly, from the point of view of this beer, they do a range of these desserts in a can, don't they? So there's been a whole range of different flavours.
What, different flavours?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I've had the chocolate and marshmallow one before. I think that was at a bottle share. Actually, that was probably one that you missed.
There must have been one I'm missing, because
otherwise you would have had that checked in. But in terms of the beer, there wasn't really a lot to find out about it, other than it's a pecan and maple pie imperial milk stout.
Well, even on tap, it doesn't say much about the beer.
No.
Which is quite unusual for a lot of these breweries these days. They actually put a little bit of blurb on it, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, most of the information that I managed to get this evening for all of the beers and breweries has come from Untapped, actually. So it's got a worldwide score on Untapped of 4.09. Up in the fours, which is kind of bucks the trend a little bit, because over time, most things generally tend to average out at about 3.75 on Untapped, I think.
I mean, I would say that initially, my initial feelings are it's worth a four. If we're talking about Untapped, just because it does exactly what it says on the tin. And do you know what it's lacking? That, you know, that boozy burn?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not getting any of that. So it's got the thickness, it's got the viscosity, it's got the chocolate, it's got the maple, but I'm not getting the burn.
Yeah.
Which you might expect for this kind of dark beer at 10.5%.
No, it's just, it is just sliding down, actually. It's velvety smooth. That's a great starting point.
It is.
Actually. So while we enjoy that, we've not been doing beery adventures when we've had guests, because we kind of felt it was a little bit rude just talking about ourselves in front of other people.
What have you done, Steve? Oh, what have you done, Martin? Oh,
yeah.
And guests. Hello.
So we've mentioned the odd thing, but we knew this show was coming up, and we thought we'd have a bit of a summary wrap up of some of the key things that we've done that maybe we've not had a chance to mention.
Well, obviously we covered Liverpool last time for the Stag Weekend.
We did.
We did that, but that was quite good because Andrew had been there recently as well, around about the same time I'd gone the first time. So, you know, he is part of the conversation as well. The thing that I only referenced last time was the Cave Direct 40th birthday.
Oh yeah.
So they held that at Beer Merchants over in Hackney, not too far from Stratford, but it was the trade session in the afternoon. So thank you very much to Cave Direct for extending the invitation to the Beer O'Clock show. And Steve couldn't make it, so the creative director selflessly gave up his afternoon
stepped
at work
in, yeah.
and stepped into your shoes.
What a trooper.
And we had a really nice afternoon. That's when we saw Rich and the other guys from Two Brews and from the Vic as well. And I just want to reference a couple of beers that I tried, and weirdly, we'd mentioned Oedipus Brewing, didn't we?
Yes,
on the news
a
few shows back about another brewery that had been taken over. This one had been taken over by Heineken, wasn't it? And I said I'd never tried their beers. I'd never even come across this brewery. And they were at Cave Direct, which is really weird.
Yeah.
And they had an IPA. It didn't say West Coast, East Coast, Hybrid or anything. It just said IPA. So I dived in on that, a few beers in. It's called Gaia. Bloody amazing.
Really?
Proper, old school, West Coast IPA, if we want to give it a reference. I give it 4.5 out of 5. Fruity, sweet, hoppy, bitter. It was just everything I still love about IPAs I used to have. Bloody fantastic. And that was really good. And then quickly moved to the left of where Gaia was. And Alex from Lost and Grounded was there.
Oh, great.
And he had a sour beer available, as well as obviously having the Keller Pils as well. The sour beer, again, was really, really good. They are so good at making these clean beers and basically making what it says it will do. 6.2%. It was almost like the perfect beer after having that really punchy West Coast IPA. It's called the Age of the Quick Fix. I'm assuming there's a bit of a play on words there for something, or a bit of a, maybe even a dig at someone. Beautiful, well balanced, and it was really nice. It was on the keg, nicely chilled as well, so it was sharp and fruity and really tasty. So although we spent 5 hours at Cave Direct, Clayton and I decided we were going to pay a visit somewhere else, as did a few of the others, and we went around the corner to Howling Hops.
So it's not far, is it? It's literally no. 5 minute walk.
Tops.
Is
that? Yeah. Tops. 5 minute stroll after you spent the afternoon drinking beer, probably. And I just dived in on one beer that I hadn't had for a little while, the Pudding Ale Chocolate Stout. I think towards the end of the day, I'd had a few fruity sours, a few West Coasts, and a few like sort of Belgian-y funky beers. And 2/3 of the Pudding Ale Chocolate Stout was perfect. We were sitting outside in the sunshine, it was a little bit chilled. So I ended up having freedom.
Oh, okay.
Just 3 2/3, mm-hmm. one after the other, banging, tasting really good. All I've written down here, light chocolate notes, balanced sweetness, slightly dry finish. Brilliant. It was really, really good. I was so impressed with it. And again, I love the vibe and the feel at Howling Hops. So I know you've got a few other choices around there. Howling Hops just feels like the most relaxed.
It's still quite vibe. Unique as well, isn't it, in terms of its setup, being straight from the tank.
And it still looks beautiful.
Yeah.
Every time you go through those double doors, you see 8, 9, 10 tanks. I think they're usually pouring from at least 8 of them. It's like, it's a sight to behold. Mm. And it just feels really relaxed. Lovely, lovely feel about it. We did go to Mother Kelly's for one, but to be honest, walking through the Olympic Park from Howling Hops back to the Mother Kelly's in Stratford, in the village these days, with all the work's going on, takes a good half hour. So we had one drink and then we were sort of done.
Yeah.
Went back to the station. Yeah. But thoroughly good afternoon. Thanks again to Cave Direct. Tasted some brilliant beers. And that's just the highlights.
Just going back to Howling Hops, have you seen today they've announced that they're changing their glassware from their little dimpled jugs to they're changing to the Craftmaster 1 2/3 glasses.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'm surprised about that.
They've gone through a bit of a rebrand as well in terms of their logo and everything. And so they've said they feel the time's right to bring their glassware a bit more up to date as well.
Although the dimpled jugs didn't have their... weren't branded, were they?
Mm.
Oh, no, actually, no, they were,
yeah,
weren't they?
I think they were,
okay. I mean, to me, again, a bit like the tank bath, but they were quite unique, actually.
Yeah, it's a shame to see them go, really.
I mean, for the 1/3, I'd actually keep the smaller ones. Maybe for the 2/3, you could differentiate, but I'd keep the 1/3 one as...
Yeah, but I suppose if they've got the old branding on and they're moving towards new branding...
Then you need to move the glasses on as well. Does that mean we can go down there and take all the glasses?
Well, they must be looking to do something with them.
In which case, we need to send Mark down there with that big coat.
Yes, with his mate's big coat.
So, Steve, that was my main beery adventure of the last month or so. What was yours?
Okay, not really one main one. Much like yourself, I mentioned something briefly on the last show, which was I went to the Vic Inn, have started doing regular comedy nights.
Oh, yeah.
And I managed to go down to one of them. It was on an evening where both Emma and I were child-free, a rare occasion on a midweek night. So we went down to that. And it's a great concept. Basically, you pay what you think it's worth. So there's no entry fee. It's upstairs in the Vic. It was good to see, actually.
Oh, so they do it separately, sorry to interrupt. So on a Sunday, they had the music in there, and they do that to the right-hand side of the bar at the back.
Yeah, no, this was upstairs.
Oh, so it was completely separate.
And it was full up there. There must have been 20, maybe 20 people up there, 20, 25 people, which is quite a small room.
Yeah, it is a small room.
It was very warm up there as well, and obviously none of the windows could open, and it was when it was warm a few weeks back. But it was great. We got 5 comedians. So we got kind of 4 in the first half that were clearly all new, and were trying their material to see what works. And then we had a bit of a break, and then there was like a headline act who had a good 20-30 minute slot. I'm shocking, I really can't remember his name, but he was really good. He was really funny. And then you just pay what you think the evening was worth. So on your way out, you just put donations in a glass.
Do you think they're going to do it again?
I think they're planning on doing it as a regular thing. Yeah. So.
Well, it's about finding what you can do, isn't it? I mean, this is a midweek evening when you might have a bit quiet in the pub.
Yeah. Yeah.
You need to find what you can do, what works.
But I had some great beers while I was there as well, obviously, which is what they're known for. So one of the ones that stood out was Hickey the Rake from Wylam.
I was going to say it's Wylam, isn't it?
Yeah, which is it's an English pale ale. I've had it before, and it was on cask as well. So I've had it before, and I think I previously rated it at 3 or 3.25, something like that. First one I had was absolutely stunning. I had 3. First one I had was absolutely stunning, and literally didn't stand my glass very long. And then literally progressively, as I had another one, It was going up by 2.25 on Untappd every time I had it. I could have just stayed on that all night long, but there was another one that I wanted to try from Dry and Bitter on their keg taps, which was just a straight up American pale ale, fizzy, cold, bitter, exactly what you want it to be. So
especially if the room upstairs for the comedy was quite warm and you had 3 pints of cask, not a good, bad switch.
Yeah, no. Well, actually, I had them before it started. And I might have took the third one up with me and then switched at half-time.
So you had 2 pints as a warm-up?
Yeah, yeah.
Because you needed to warm up.
I had my own warm-up.
You had a warm-up before the comedians warmed up.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So yeah, great idea. Great concept that the Vic are doing there. And like I say, I'm pretty sure they've got some more lined up. And I do hope it's something they continue because it was a good evening. And it's always good to showcase local talent as well.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's worth doing.
Yeah, and then just the other things. We've had a couple of bottle shares since we've been doing our little tour, and the most recent one, which was last week, as we recalled this, absolute standout beer of the evening for me was from actually a homebrew from one of the regulars to bottle share.
From Max.
Bottle share from Max, who brews under the name He Brews. And this was Top Rope Pile Driver, which was an American Imperial Double Stout that he had aged on
oak chips,
bourbon-soaked oak chips. Yeah. It was stunning. I know Max listens to the show, so Max, hats off for that beer, mate. It was
brilliant.
Really, really good. And like I say, it was, for me, that was actually better than all of the commercial beers we had at the last bottle
show. There was definitely a few that aren't your preferred style anyway.
Yeah.
But no, Max is a good brewer anyway. Generally brings his own beers along. That is easy, one of the best he's done.
Yes, and it's, absolutely.
And that's against some very good ones he's done in the past.
Yeah, he's always consistent with his beers, and he has done a single version of that beer called Pile Driver. There is a bit of a wrestling theme going on with some of his beer names and labels.
That's probably why I knocked down a few points.
but that was incredible. Just really, really.
No, it was really good.
Goodness. I think it's great to see still bottle share going from strength to strength. I think we're on what, 54 events now. We've hit nearly 600 unique beers.
Kind of a couple of months time, 4.5 years.
Yeah.
Which is pretty damn good.
Yeah.
Bearing in mind that Clayton, the creative director, has been there for all of them.
He's still attended every single one. Yeah.
He is the ever-present. What are you thinking about the beer halfway through?
It's okay. It's the sweetness is getting a bit sticky now. I mean, I wouldn't say it's warmed up because we served it at room temperature. I do wonder if we had served it
cold,
a little bit colder, whether it would have been easier, quicker. To drink.
I mean, I wouldn't want, without going off on a tangent, 330 can between two on this particular beer is fine for me.
Oh, absolutely. I don't think I'd be able to finish a whole can of that on my own.
No, this is enough. We're only about halfway through our half share anyway.
It's thick. It's just so thick. It's not a beer that we're going to drink quickly.
No, not normally a beer we'd start with, but bearing in mind what's coming up.
We thought it was the best.
Best one to start
best
with.
Best starting place. While we finish this, let's have a look at the news, because we've got a few news items to get into. And the first one, and I'm quite proud of the heading that I've given this in the news. This is a combined news item that I'm calling The Beer Hawk Spreads Its Wings. So in a 24-hour period last week, Beer Hawk, who are now owned by ABI or ZX Ventures.
Yeah, I was going to say through their ZX Venture arm, isn't it?
Made two announcements in terms of acquisitions.
They made one announcement and then the other announcement was made by...
Yes. So everybody knows what we're talking about. So the first one was there was an announcement about the now defunct bottle shop business.
Yep.
And Beer Hawk essentially taking that over as a going concern of sorts. And then the following day, we had the announcement from Beer Bods that they were teaming up with Beer Hawk as well, and that they had basically sold the entirety of Beer Bods to Beer Hawk.
I mean, this was... I found the timing of Beer Bods release quite odd compared to the release about the bottle shop as well. But yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to address that one straight away. Okay. I spoke to Matt Lane at Beer Bods today.
Okay, cool. Hello, Matt.
Because he offered us an opportunity to have a chat with him once the news had broke. So I spoke to him today, and that was actually one of the questions I asked him. I was like, did you know when you had obviously planned to make your announcement and when you were going to make it, did you know that Beer Hawk were about to make the announcement on the Thursday? And he said, I had absolutely no idea. And he said, yeah, their timing was pretty bad in terms of it being the day before.
It's dreadful.
Yeah.
Dreadful timing.
But from their point of view, I wouldn't have thought it happened by mistake.
Maybe not. Maybe just they're expecting a bit of backlash. Let's have it all in one go in 24 hours.
Yeah.
But it was still odd from a lot of perspectives.
Yeah, but we'll come back to the beer bods discussion in a moment. Let's focus on the bottle shop one first of all. So the story was put out by Glyn Davis, who's the editor of Beer Insider, and Glyn was quite open when the bottle shop business collapsed, and he was open again in this piece that he's personally lost money.
Through Bohem, isn't it?
Yeah, and through crowdfunding as well. So you know that was with full disclosure. But when Glyn broke it, he basically goes on to say that so Beer Hawk taken it over and they've essentially reinstated the bottle shop founder Andrew Morgan, who's now going to be the head of Beer Hawk B2B. Which I assume is business to business.
Yeah.
And suggests, and in that one statement as well, Andrew Morgan also went on to basically point the finger at the rest of the industry, saying it was their fault that bottle shop failed, which seemed to be quite a way to come blazing out of the gates.
Pretty disingenuous and quite frankly dishonest as well.
Yeah.
It's your own business. It's your fault. You can't go around blaming other people. And every word in that statement, and I'm not an investor, and I didn't have a particular love for Bottle Shop, I liked it, but I wasn't personally invested in it. They've got all that beer still there.
Yeah.
All that old that stock just dying. The people might get their money back, but they're never going to get the full amount. And he just literally just blamed everyone.
Yeah.
About no contracts. Well, it's your business. If you want the contract, have the contract then.
Then you should have put it in place, yeah. He did go on to say, yeah, particularly pointing the finger at Beavertown and McKellar, who removed their took their contracts away from Bottle Shop. And as you say, when it went out of business, there's a load of breweries that have been left with unpaid bills and piles of kegs and bottles locked and legally inaccessible in a Canning Town warehouse.
Yeah. But these are beers that were sanctioned to be bought when they knew there were problems.
Yeah.
Knew there were problems. And they just carried on and brought them in anyway. I had a little bit of sympathy about Bottle Shop when they first went under, because I thought they were quite trailblazing. Did the business model work? Probably not. But bollocks to that, that was shit.
Yeah, I mean, he does seem to have a little remorse.
He's like, do you remember that bit in that I never used to watch The Office much? But it's a bit where David Brent goes, everyone else has been sacked, and he goes, but on the upside, I've been promoted. That's fairly much what he's doing.
Because he's got a job again now.
He's basically sticking up two fingers at both investors and the people he used to work with and for him. And he's just gone, yeah, but I'm okay.
Yeah.
Seriously, no interest in anything to do with that.
So let's just have a look at what ABI have actually got for their money. So no figures have actually been disclosed in terms of how much they've paid for the business. But they've got the warehouse and its cold chain platform that they say can now be implemented with proper funding from ABI, and a new 65,000 square foot warehouse is also being built as well. They're also in the process of looking at taking over the license for the bottle shop unit in Druid Street, which is on the Bermondsey Beer Mile, which I think was the first thing that a lot of people pointed out, was that ABI have now got a presence in
the Bermondsey Beer Mile,
one of the craft hot spots in the UK. So that broke on
that was Thursday afternoon.
Yeah,
late
Thursday afternoon. But that particular story doesn't end there, because today there's been a follow-up piece by Matt Curtis at Total Curtis, who has spoken to the managing director of Beer Hawk to clear up some of the confusion that he feels there was surrounding some of these statements. So Matt goes on to say, the bottle shop is still in administration and the appointed administrators are in the process of liquidating the company's assets. The responsibility for the management of any outstanding debts is with them. Beer Hawk has acquired the lease of the Canning Town cold storage site, which will become a cold chain distribution point for the London area. Part of that acquisition includes the stock that's still within that building. They have only just got access to that building, so we're in the process of stock checking it this week. None of it has passed into their retail or wholesale channels as yet. Crucial detail, Beer Hawk has not acquired any of the bottle shop's debt in this transaction. As stated earlier in the thread, that responsibility lies with the administrators. Beer Hawk will not acquire the bottle shop's Bermondsey site, as negotiations are still taking place between its landlord and its administrators. Beer Hawk B2B is simply an extension of Beer Hawk Trade, something France hopes to grow more effectively with its new London distribution point. So it's interesting that there seems to be a different side to that story, and whereas one piece kind of focused on giving this Andrew Morgan a bit of a mouthpiece and a bit of an opportunity to sound off, the other piece has actually looked into what it actually means.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I wouldn't give him the time of day ever again. So that's his probably last mention on this show. I think Matt Curtis's thread was very good because it did clear up some of the confusion. I still suspect one of the bottle shop retail sites is going to reopen, though. Surely it's too good an opportunity not to.
Well, it would be the one.
It's going to be one of those BMRs where the most amount of people go.
Absolutely.
So you know the local ones, which I had down in Canterbury and was it Margate? It was that neck of the woods, wasn't there three in total? I suspect it's going to be Drury Street. But yeah, I mean it's good to get the clarification. I still think nothing wrong with the article, but. That's it. Wouldn't give him the time of day again.
Yeah. Well, we'll put links in the show notes to both Glyn's article and to Matt's thread, which interestingly is the first time I've seen that kind of. It's almost a new type of journalism in terms of releasing a story as a thread on Twitter rather than as everything I just read out there was from a series of tweets.
I mean,
Matt.
It could well be there's going to be a longer read coming up anyway. A bit more detail on it, but I appreciated Matt's clarification on those items anyway.
Yeah. So that was Thursday.
We thought that was it. The news sorted out.
And then Friday morning, around about 11 o'clock, the news dropped that beer bods had sold to Beer Hawk as well. And Twitter had one of its moments where it went into a little bit of a meltdown.
Yes.
Over that one. So headline stuff. Is that basically beer bods want to do more. It's become increasingly clear that for them to reach at their full potential, they needed to partner up with someone to take them to the next level. They went on to say that they've known Matt and Chris from Beer Hawk since 2012, and they felt as though they're the perfect fit for the business. So Matt's going to be staying around to head up beer bods. Essentially, beer bods will continue as beer bods. There'll be no branding change. There'll be no name change. It will still be beer bods. It's just funded by the different.
I mean, it's probably just to clarify there. Beer Hall kind of became part of ABI via the ventures in 2016, didn't it?
Yes.
So they'd obviously known the guys for a while before that particular takeover taking place as well. You managed to speak to Matt.
I did, yes. So we had some questions for Matt, because I think I made a comment pretty much straight away. I think I retweeted the news that Beer Bods had released and said, oh, another one for us to discuss on this week's show. And Matt DM'd me straight away and was like, I'm happy to have a conversation with you guys. So,
to be fair, he had a busy day on Friday.
He did have a busy day on Friday, yeah. So I spoke to Matt this morning and asked him a number of questions. And Matt's given me full license to kind of repeat some of the things that he said in that discussion as well. So first question I asked him was why did you choose to sell, why now? And he said basically, anybody that knows Matt knows that the beer bod started as a passion project, so it wasn't his full-time job when he started, but he knew straight away that he was onto something, and it grew quickly between 2012 and 2014. However, they noticed that when they got to last year, so when they got to 2018, the market started getting a little bit tougher in terms of the money that was coming in. And he put that down to competition, the economy, Brexit. He said all these things have had an impact on the business and its ability to grow any further in its current state. So he felt as though they've taken it as far as they could. And that now was the right time for them to seek out a partner. So the investment was essentially to help beer bods grow and to take it to the next level. That's what they wanted to do. He said he felt as though they've gone as far as they can go with it, but they want it to go further now.
Did he feel that they need to carry on growing to stay relevant?
I think so. He did mention there's a lot of competition now. He said when they launched, they were the only beer subscription service, or one of very few.
One of the very few, and a bit of a unique selling point as well.
So in terms of choosing to go with Beer Hawk and ZX Ventures, he said obviously there's been a lot of discussions that they've had. And he said, I can't tell you all the details because a lot of it is wrapped up legally in the contract, which I'm not allowed to disclose, which is fair enough. But what he did say was that they understand the magic in the beer bods community. And essentially, what they've effectively bought is the beer bods hashtag and the name and that Thursday night community, because they could see the value in that. That's what he said. He said as the community grows, the business will get stronger. So the more that community grows, the stronger beer bods will continue to get, and this will enable them to grow that community a little bit further. And I suppose, we've seen in the last few years the contents of the boxes have changed, haven't they?
And they've changed a few of the ways they do it, and they've got the box you can build up over a 30-day period as well, which you can do online. Beer bods ones to watch, beer bods plus.
So there's plenty of offering.
I mean, when I joined in 2013, it was the one box, one beer every Thursday. That box lasted you 3 months, £36 a month. There or thereabouts.
It's great value.
Yeah.
It's absolutely great value. Obviously, he did make a point of saying that one of the things that does set beer bods apart is the Thursday night community that they've grown, and that will absolutely continue. There's no plans for that to stop. That's what they're good at. That's where their engagement is, and that will continue for the foreseeable future. They still have full control over picking the beers.
Well, this was a few of the comments on Twitter, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So, like all of these things, once the news came out, there was a lot of back and forth, and we'll come to the investment bit in due course anyway. But one of the things which came out was, well, will you now start having to push ABI beers, ABI inspired beers, ABI connected beers, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But from what you're saying in your conversation with Matt and the stuff I'd read, basically he's still saying, going on the same thing, if it's good beer with a good story, it goes in the box. Is that fairly much what his message was?
That is absolutely it. He did make a point of saying that they've never said they were anti-big beer. They've always said they're anti-bad beer.
There's always been, even in when I was doing it, I think I did it for the best part of 4 years. It's £36 a box. There would be a few in there which you would have thought, it's probably less than £3 if I was really searching it out. And then there would be a few which you thought, actually, I can't get hold of that. Or I wouldn't have been getting hold of it.
Yeah.
So I can understand what he's saying, but I can also understand the questions from other people saying, is this just going to become an extension of the ABI world?
Mm-hmm.
So again, good to know they're able to keep some control over it. And I suppose if they are buying the beer bods community, the hashtag beer bods, the Thursday nights, you could easily kill that quite quickly.
Yeah.
Couldn't you?
Yeah, well, you just stop doing it, don't you?
So then it just becomes a subscription service.
Yeah. Just another subscription service. So I did ask Matt if there was an option for him to have actually taken the money and walked away. And again, he said that there were things there that he couldn't disclose. But he was very clear in saying he wanted to stay and they wanted him to stay. They wanted him to still head up Beer Bods and to still run it as it is. And again, he went on to say it's an opportunity to make it as good and as big as it can be. And he didn't want to, basically, he didn't want to walk away from his baby and let somebody else grow it.
Again, I can understand that as well, because I think that was a question I was interested in, because it could be quite easy to just go, right, okay, done my bit. Maybe I'll take a back seat for a while and maybe I'll start something again in another year, 2 years. We've seen that with breweries.
Yeah.
But with brewers moving on. So I can understand him wanting to stay, because I think the whole team's staying, isn't it?
Yes, all of them, yeah.
And staying where they are. They're based, is it Worcestershire?
Mm-hmm.
They're staying exactly where they are, aren't they?
Yeah. And then the last thing I asked him was about Friday and essentially how was social media for you on Friday? And he said he was actually overwhelmed by the positive and supportive comments that he got from both customers and investors. He said, looking back on it, 95% of the comments were positive and that was good for them. And as a result of them being quite open and honest about it, they've said they've had new breweries have already been in touch to say that they still want to work with them as well. So that growth that he talks about seems to already be happening as a result of them saying, look, here's what's happening, here's where we're going with the business.
I mean, full disclosure, I've met Matt a couple of times. I think he's a lovely bloke. Yeah. But I do have a question. Did you touch upon the investment side? Because obviously investors invested X amount, I think over two runs of crowdfunding.
Yeah.
And from what I heard, the return is not quite as good as some other ABI-related buyouts.
Yeah. I'll be honest, he was a little bit cagey around what he was allowed to share and what he wasn't. So he wasn't trying to hide anything. Yeah. He was just saying, and he did say that some of the things that have been reported on Twitter are just factually incorrect. He did say those that invested in 2017 will see a poor return from their investment because it was a late investment and it's not had the time to grow. He did simply say, unfortunately, it's a harsh reality. They had to make a decision as to whether to sell or not and to get what they considered to be the best value for the business and for the investors. And what they were offered was what they considered was the best offer that they were being given.
Okay, so to me, that indicates it wasn't just about wanting to grow the business. There was issues.
Yeah, I think there was an underlying bit of that in terms of him saying, you know, that the market was getting tougher. And, you know, it can't have helped them, the availability of great beer in supermarkets.
Oh, God, no.
These
and
days.
I'm not saying when people invest, everyone's quite clear, your money can go up, money can go down. But I think some people are probably surprised at what they lost. And again, on top of the other recent crowdfunding issues that has been, you know, read out, you know, we've just mentioned Bottle Shop, for example. So people have lost money in these things. And I perhaps fear for the future of crowdfunding in the drinks industry, particularly the beer industry going forward, that if we carry on having this sort of negative noise about it, negative news, that people are going to be a lot more wary, and it's going to make some of those businesses which could be tip top and could be sustainable might not be able to do it anymore in that kind of sense.
Yeah.
I mean, like I said, I know Matt, I've met Matt. I used to be a beer bod subscriber, was never an investor. Haven't invested in that many things, to be honest, beer wise. I hope for him and his team it works. and I hope they do keep the creative control. And I do hope the beer buds community on a Thursday survives as well. I mean, the only thing is, time will tell, I suppose.
Absolutely, yeah. We have spoken to some of our listeners as well, who are subscribers to beer bod. So, and that certainly the two that I spoke to were quite happy for us to mention them by name. Michael McGrority, I'm really not sure at the moment. I've never really had a problem with brewery ownership, and I do actually drink ABI beer semi-regularly, but this feels different somehow. Maybe because we have so much more of a personal connection with beer bods as we interact directly with them on a weekly basis. I'll mull it over for a while, I think. Probably stick with it for a time being while I gather my thoughts. And then the other one is Justin Mason, who's, you know, regular contributor to the show. And I think Justin's been in since the beginning.
Yeah, and I've got feedback from someone who's been in there since the start as well.
So Justin said, it's interesting that the announcement email sent to subscribers just mentions acquisition by Beerhawk, with only the link to read the announcement in full, mentioning that Beerhawk were acquired by ZX Ventures, the innovation arm of ABIn Bev, in 2016. That could easily have been in the original email sent rather than in the link, which doesn't really go into much more detail. When things are hidden, even inadvertently, I'm immediately suspicious. We'll see, I guess. But neither of them talking about cancelling subscription or anything anytime soon.
No, it feels like we'll watch this space and see what happens.
Yeah.
However, good friend of the show, already referenced, Clayton, who I work with, creative director. He was the one who introduced me to beer bods. Effectively, he has cancelled.
Okay.
He cancelled his on Friday lunchtime, his box straight away as a subscriber. Credit where credit's due to beer bods. It is actually incredibly easy to cancel. There are some subscribers out there who make it incredibly difficult to cancel your subscription. Beer bods continue to lead the way with that kind of thing by making it actually quite easy to just stop your box. So if you've already got it, you've already ordered it, that's coming through, but you can stop the subscription to the next one. So plaudits there from my point of view. So he has cancelled it. He'd been fairly much in since the start. So he's a 6-year plus investor slash subscriber. So his main thoughts were, he doesn't think that an ABI-owned venture can build or continue to build a sort of community that beer bods did as an independent startup. That was a big part of the first years of his subscription. The beer club will continue and probably grow, though perhaps missing a little piece of its soul, I do buy beer from ABI, said Clayton, and other multinational companies, but I'll pick and choose how and when. There hasn't been as much communication to investors about what's gone wrong. It necessitated a buyout, assuming mounting debt and falling or flat revenue. Clayton feels it would have been nice to have a bit of a more in-depth explanation of that as an investor. So as a subscriber on one level, as an investor on another level. And to be fair, I probably would have echoed his thoughts about the subscriber. And if I had been an investor, I probably would have appreciated a bit of a heads up on it as well. I think the email to investors came through shortly before the announcement, 11 o'clock publicly. So it would have been easy as an investor to have missed that for a bit.
Yeah.
Well, I also acknowledge you don't want then investors splashing it all over social media as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose the timeline has to be quite fine. Any thoughts? I mean, you've never been a beer bod subscriber per se, have you?
I haven't. I did buy one of their beer bods plus boxes once and tried to get involved in that, but I found that that community wasn't as strong as the normal Thursday night community.
So that was at 10 o'clock on a Thursday, wasn't it, rather than 9 o'clock?
The normal beer bod subscription has never really done it for me in terms of the beers that come through, and it wasn't something that I was ever really interested in doing. I think looking at the two announcements, firstly, I'm surprised that they came so quickly.
Uh-huh.
As I said earlier, Matt was very surprised that the announcement dropped the day before they were due to announce their news. One feels like it's slightly more trying to influence the market than the other, which is very much the bottle shop route in terms of the distribution network, so that potentially opens up for them having a space on the Bermondsey Beer Mile. That those are the sort of things that seem to be a little bit more clandestine
Definitely clandestine. I think the public happy face is the beer bottle one.
Yeah, I'm a massive fan of what beer bods do, even though I've never actually subscribed them. We've done some work with them.
Yeah.
You know, full disclosure, we've had boxes from them in the past, and we've done team ups with beer bods, and hopefully that will continue as well. I think what they've built is a fantastic community, and I think it's a very loyal community as well. What will be interesting to see will be kind of this next Thursday evening, to see what the engagement is like and whether any of this forms any part of the discussion or whether the focus still remains on the beer.
I'll be really surprised if someone doesn't try to jump in with some comments.
Oh, probably not a subscriber.
Yeah.
As well. Someone will try and use it as a platform.
Oh, definitely. You've got the hashtag, you've got the audience.
Yeah.
You can do it.
I think for me, the underlying thing, particularly with beer bods, is if they've still got control over the boxes and they still get to pick and choose what goes in there, I think what this enables them is access to a much larger palette in terms of what beers they could potentially be choosing and getting to put in those boxes.
Oh, definitely. There's buying power there. Let's be honest, there is buying power. And beer bods could quite easily go from strength to strength. I would echo Clayton's sentiments, and perhaps even Michael's to a further degree is that because people have invested in the community, the same reason I always felt that there was such a big fallout with Camden, people have invested in more than just the beer, more than just the place, more than just the things, something a bit more intangible, then maybe they may lose a few of those. But as a subscription service, where if you are inclined to take those first steps into the social media world, then generally that beer bod's hour is quite a friendly environment, to be honest.
Yep, and that's the thing that I hope continues.
So do I.
And I hope it continues to thrive.
Yes.
As well. And I hope it continues to grow. And I will quite openly say, good luck to Matt and the team. You know, I think it was a brave decision to make. It clearly wasn't one that he made lightly, and I do hope it sees beer bods go from strength to strength.
Yeah, good luck, Matt. But I don't envy your position right now.
Oh no, absolutely not. So we're going to have another beer. While we're having another beer, there is just one final comment that I want to say on the beer bods discussion, which was, well, not on the beer bods discussion, but on those acquisitions discussion. And this was a couple of tweets that were made by Chris Hall at Chris Hall Beer. Most of our listeners will know Chris as a beer writer. I believe he also works for Howling Hops.
Currently working at Howling Hops.
So he said, putting all my emotions into a hermetically sealed container for a moment, the recent activities of ABI ZX Ventures Beerhawk have been surgical and frankly quite impressive. They've now got one wholesale business with a cold store and a whole bunch of debt and old beer, but still. Two, highly desirable on and off licensed retail space to add to their estate. Three, well-regarded direct delivery subscription model with incredible customer engagement. The UK craft beer sector is still the Wild West, and ABI ZX Beerhawk is ruthlessly exploiting this. We can no longer say that businesses are that big are slow in action. It feels like they're running circles around craft. Where is the independent coordination, organisation or strategy?
Which I think was sort of nailed what had happened, nailed what is happening. And again, I don't think we'll go into detail now, but led on to a bit of a side conversation about like SIBA in this particular environment right now. And I think they were getting quite engaged at times as well. So that was quite interesting.
Yeah. Although saying that, give SIBA credit where it's due. We mentioned on the last show about their new chief executive.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen a lot more of SIBA in my timeline in the last couple of weeks since that fella's taken over.
Well, what I've seen is him responding.
Yes, he is very active.
And SIBA responding.
Yeah.
So I've seen a lot more. And also, what I did see was a lot of clarification about some of the myths being, some of the rules being debunked that perhaps were rules before, but in the last couple of years, motions have been passed. So that was quite interesting. Maybe we'll come back to it in another show, but
yeah,
because probably haven't got time to do it justice tonight. Plus, I think this is still running.
Yeah, I think so. Because he's only been in post a couple of weeks. But
you know, maybe we'll get the chance to talk to him at some point about
that'd be
which
great,
I would actually really like to do because he seems really engaged about the whole thing. But like I said, a few people started to talk about getting, you know, getting more involved with SIBA, and then the whole conversation about, you know, can you affect change from the outside in or the inside out? What's the best way to do it? So I think this has got, this is perhaps maybe a bit of a kickstart to a few people about how they can actually start to band together. And perhaps if they do want to form a united front, which let's face it, probably doesn't exist at the moment. You know, there was the Craft Beer Alliance, which lasted one night.
Yeah.
And that died pretty quickly. So perhaps this is the kick up the arse, which maybe some breweries and outlets feel they need. Interesting to see where this goes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think this is a watching brief, this one.
Yes, definitely.
We've got a new beer in front of us.
We have. Now, Will promised / threatened.
At least one Merc Bomb.
And we have, I believe, the Merc Bomb in front of us.
I think so. Yeah, so, I mean, it looks like orange juice in a glass.
I have poured us the other half, double dry hopped, triple India Pale Ale, which comes in at another sessionable 10.5%, Steve.
Marvellous.
I think he's chosen this for two reasons. One, murky and juicy, but also because the label is literally green and just says all green everything. So I reckon that inspired part of his choice.
Quite possibly, yeah.
It does look and smell like a murky juice bomb. There's only one way to find out, though.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Oh, I mean, it's tropical on the nose.
It's almost like a cooked smell to the tropical fruit as well.
Yeah.
Almost as if it had been like, and I don't like it, pineapple on a pizza. It feels like it's got cooked fruit.
Yeah.
That is thick as well, isn't it?
That is thick.
Now, again, I had a bit of a look, and I have had a beer from Other Half Brewing.
I never have. This is my first.
And I think it's fair to say they're pretty much a sought-after brewery. People do talk about Other Half.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
I was lucky enough to try one when I was in the States, when I had my brief visit to New York when I was staying in Boston, and tried the Fruit Dream, in brackets, with cherry and vanilla. About an hour before I had this beer, I'd had probably the sweetest, most calorific milkshake in the world ever at a place called the Chocolate Factory in New York. And the Fruit Dream was a Berliner Weiss, a little bit sour, fruity, chilled. It was like the perfect antidote at that point. It was lovely. This, however, does tick the box of not being in my preferred style.
See, now that's interesting because it's not my preferred style. It certainly isn't, but I don't mind it. It's got a bit of a sugary sweetness to it, and there is a strange fruit juice like bitterness to the end of it. It's not the crisp cutting bitterness that I like. It's more of a sticky bitterness.
Say fruit pithy sharpness.
Yes, yeah.
Which I usually only get from fruit which isn't quite ripe.
Yeah. Again, I'm glad we're sharing a can. I'm not sure I would be able to do more than,
so
than half of a can.
So this is a 16 fluid ounces, which I suppose is the 473 millilitres that the Americans have. It's a good sharing size for this kind of beer. I would struggle with the whole can of it. But again, I don't think I've had a New England style triple IPA.
No, me either.
So to be fair to it, I haven't got a benchmark either.
This is a first.
But there is definitely a sharpness to it at the end.
Yeah, well, what they've done with this one, because this is double dry hopped all green everything. Now there is a standard all green everything as well. Going through Other Half's website, looking at their beer releases, there are pages and pages and pages and pages and pages of beer releases that you have to look through, because they're one of these breweries that is kind of one and done.
Oh, they're prolific.
Yeah, sort of thing. So, but this version was brewed with Amarillo, Motueka, Citra and Mosaic. And then it was double dry hopped with Citra and Mosaic lupulin powder. And they changed the yeast strains in this one for a fruitier finish to it as well. So from the original one, they decided to go for a fruitier edge to this one. On Untappd, this one scores 4.45 globally, which is very high score.
I can understand why, though.
Yeah.
If this is a style you like, because we're quite a big fan of the West Coast triple IPAs when they turn out right before they start maybe maturing towards that barley wine kind of state. So if the It's got all that fruit juice element on the nose. It's got the fruit juice to start off with. And it does tell you it's a big beer.
Yeah, you take all that juicy out of that. That'd be a perfect beer.
I mean, it's a game of two halves almost.
Yeah, absolutely.
The first half is completely different to the finish.
Yeah, I mean, I am actually drinking it quite quickly.
You are drinking it quite quick.
It's quite refreshing after that first one.
Well, yeah, I mean, after the first one.
That's what it is.
I think you should read some more news before you start.
Well, let me give you a little bit more about other half before we go back to news. So they're from Brooklyn in the States. Founded in 2014 by Sam Richardson, Matt Moynihan and Andrew Berman. And they had a simple mission to create beers that they wanted to drink from a company that they wanted to be part of. In 2014, there was a new legal act, the Craft New York Act, which allowed breweries to sell cans and bottles of beer directly to customers for the first time from their breweries, which meant they could now start promoting their beers via social media. And that's where we've seen kind of, they're one of the breweries where you get the classic pictures of queues around the door. But they're now producing annually 14,000 barrels. Now that's US barrels. So the guide that we've got on our show notes from Sean will be of no use.
No, because I was just looking at that.
Yeah. So Sean, we do need a new conversion for US barrels. But please.
I mean, isn't that weird though? But it's the Craft New York Act. So presumably every state passed, because I saw Tritium, and I know that other breweries had those big queues outside, so they're starting to sell direct. Isn't this the same conversation that they're still having in Ireland, that they can't do that?
It is, yes. Yeah.
So they can have their open days, but people can't just rock up and buy beer to take away.
Yeah.
Whereas, like I said, when I was at Tritium, people were taking away slabs. It was like people were going to the supermarket and just taking slabs of beer, but they were taking it direct from the people who'd made it from their cold store. And they were taking like 24, 48 cans of beer.
Yeah.
So it must make a hell of a difference to your direct income and also your direct engagement as well.
Absolutely. So, you know, like you say, when you've got queues of people that are queuing from hours before you open to get their allocation of beer.
Yeah.
And then you essentially sell out on a day.
Yeah. And that all of them are posting on social media.
Yeah.
So it just grows. It's a bit like, maybe not so much now, but a couple of years ago with the Bourbon County Stout. Although you knew there was only like 20 bottles or something, there would be a queue of more than 20 people. So I think it's really good that you can actually sell direct to the public. And this is where America is one of those countries which is, there's so many things to admire about America. And then you go, really? You only been able to start selling beer direct to customers 5 years ago?
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it?
It is crazy. There's so many bits. So, you know, I enjoyed the first beer I had from them. This beer, I think there's a little way to go for us anyway. But still, very thankful that Will chose this one, though.
Let's finish the news, because there are a couple of other stories. So, BrewDog have broken into the world's 25 most valuable beer brands.
Who judges this? Because I saw the headline, but I couldn't work out who judges the... Who's made this call, this judgment?
Brand Finance.
Okay.
They're an operator of 91 venues worldwide. No, that's BrewDog, the operator of 91.
I was going to say, otherwise 91 venues is...
No, Brand Finance have produced the report.
Okay.
So I don't know much about
that. No, nor do I. So, I have to say. Okay, so it's independent of the beer world, sort of.
Yeah, yeah. So BrewDog have gone into the top 25 list at number 19, sandwiched between Carlsberg at number 20 and Chang at number 18. Also on the list at number 14, Stella Artois, number 12, Asahi, number 10, Guinness, and then the top three in reverse order, number 3, Heineken, number 2, Bud Light, and number 1, Budweiser.
I thought Bud Light used to be the number 1 US beer.
Well, no, this is Worlds.
Oh, Worlds, of course, yeah.
The world. This, say what you like about BrewDog, this is quite a big thing, I think.
Oh, yeah. It's not even I think, it definitely is. I mean, if you're sandwiched in between, what do you say, Carlsberg and Chang?
Yeah.
I think Carlsberg we put out to BrewDog just about them.
There isn't another craft beer label on that list of 25.
Well, let's move away from the craft beer label. Is there another UK label on there?
No, the closest is Guinness, but that they're classed as Ireland, obviously.
Yeah,
because they are the only United Kingdom.
Yeah, so I say forget about the other side of it. That's the only UK brand on there, and I can't imagine many other UK brands getting on there.
No, but I think that's incredible that BrewDog have actually done that.
I would still say credit where credit's due. There's plenty of things BrewDog get wrong, plenty of things BrewDog get right, and there's a bit in the middle, which is sort of where I sit with them, like a few other companies. I would say that's impressive. The 12 to 13 years?
Something like that, yeah.
To be... Because those are big macro brands on that list. You haven't read out the whole list, you just read out a few highlights.
Yeah.
And BrewDog are only a few places behind Asahi, and they're responsible for buying Fuller's.
Yeah.
And BrewDog, as you said, 91 outlets. I know they're beer in more places than 91 outlets, but they've done remarkably well.
You know where you won't be seeing their beer anymore? In beer bods boxes. that's for sure. It'll be interesting to keep an eye on that, though, and see if next year they move up in that list.
I think if they were there, they're looking to at least stay in there. But yeah, I reckon they'll be trying to progress.
Because there's constant expansion in BrewDog, isn't
there?
Yes,
that's their model. Always,
yeah, yeah. Staying with Scotland for a second. They've launched a brewing apprenticeship in Scotland. So a modern apprenticeship has been launched in Scotland with backing from industry leaders and employers. Commissioned by Skills Development Scotland, the programme was developed by the National Skills Academy for Food and Drink with support from industry leadership body Scotland Food and Drink and companies such as Tennant Caledonian, Islay Owls and Diageo are involved. The apprenticeship will allow students to learn their trade while working for a company developed in consultation with the Scottish brewing industry. The programme will develop a pipeline of recruits into the workforce and provide training and development for those currently working in brewing.
Oh, cool.
I think that's great news, isn't it? Especially when we heard in recent news on a show
that Martians have pulled out of the cask beer.
Removing cask lines. It's great to hear that actually Scotland are investing in brewing.
Yeah, but on a wider note, I think apprenticeships are so important.
Oh, absolutely.
Not everyone wants to do further education.
You've got a vocational outlet.
You should have the option of
fantastic, yeah.
Some sort of apprenticeship at 16 and 18. You shouldn't have to be forced down the further education route. And if that happens to be something which you can get into and become a lifelong career out of it, all well and good.
Totally agree. And then the last story, and this is a great one to hear. So
I'm surprised about this one.
Yeah, an unlikely partnership,
yeah.
Maybe. So Donzoco, who are based up in Newcastle and are famed for their Northern Hells lager, are looking at how they can expand production of that. So after a year and a half of brewing it, they've admitted they can't keep up with the demand for it. It also means they haven't got capacity for doing seasonals, bringing on new customers, and cans of Hells has disappeared from all shelves. So they've teamed up with Gypsy Hill Brewing in London, who are going to start brewing the Hells for them. Gypsy Hills Brewery. Now, again, forgive me, I've forgotten the guy's name, but the guy that runs Donzoco is going to be going down to London to brew Hells. He's going to install his House Acid Culture. That's not a musical track or a rave.
I was going to say, I suddenly got back to the late 1980s there.
Yeah, and they're going to then get the process as dialed in as close to the original recipe as they can. Reason for choosing Gypsy Hill, he says they've got the best quality control that he's seen in any independent brewery. And it now means that there'll be great, fresh Northern Hells available in both London and Newcastle.
And they've worked with them before as well, haven't they?
Yeah, they've done a collab together before.
I think that's really interesting. That they've decided, because they're making so much Hells, they need to find a way of expanding without expanding their home site.
Yep.
But also to go and work with a brewery that is still growing themselves as well. And I mean, I've had some good, really good Gypsy Hill beers recently. And I'm quite surprised. They must be quite clever to be able to fit it all in.
Yes. Especially if he's going to be bringing down his own yeast and culture, because that is going to not infect, but it will have an impact on the tank that's being used to brew that beer.
Well, that tank's off limits, effectively.
Yeah.
At least for a while. Because I know that you can, obviously, we know that a large percentage of brewing is cleaning, so there'll be rigorous cleaning, but you only need it once to be not quite right.
Yep.
And for some of those other Gypsy Hill beers to come out a little bit odd, and people would be on them straight away.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Because Gypsy Hill have built up a really good reputation.
Yeah, and like you say, they're churning out new beers. Yeah, well, their beers are really good.
They had a tap takeover when we were in Liverpool, didn't they? Dead Craft.
Yes, yeah.
And there were still two or three on when we were up there, and we tried them off with their Rickson.
Yeah.
Well, it's an interesting development. I hope it works.
So do I. And it'll be, you know, it's great to see two small, independent businesses getting together to essentially help each other out.
Who says the North and South can't work together?
Exactly. What are you thinking of the beer then? Are you coming around to it, or are you still struggling on this one?
No, I am warming to it. That real fruity, cloying bit at the start, then matched by a very sharp fruit finish, has mellowed a little bit as I've got used to it. Plus, for the last 5 minutes we've been talking about the news, I've just been sipping it without thinking about it, so I haven't overanalyzed it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and actually, it's now not starting to drink. It's 10.5.
It's slightly going the other way for me as it's beginning to warm.
You're enjoying less.
Yeah, I'm beginning to find it more cloying.
That's generally how we do go on these beers.
Yeah. So I think for me, this style of beer needs to be drunk ice cold and quickly.
Ice cold and quickly, whereas we've drunk it ice cold but moderate pace.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we've still got a bit to go, so we'll see how that goes.
Okay. Well then, that's all the news. That's all the adventures done. So it's time to get on to this week's question.
Hopinions, 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 Hopinions.
So this was about preferred size of prepackaged beer. So we were basically put out three options: 330ml, 440ml, or 500ml. Record number of votes for a Hopinions poll: 1,305 votes, with 44% of the people voting going for 440ml, 34% going for 330, and 22% going for 500. Now, interestingly, this is the second time we've done this poll. We last did it back in July 2016, almost to the date where we're recording here. It was done on July the 24th.
Very different sizes as well.
And different sizes back then as well. So when we did it last time, and when we did it last time, it was all about bottles.
Yes. So yeah, and you better pick this up from the size choices. So what were the choices?
330ml, 500ml, or 660ml.
Which is bottles. That's bottles.
That's all bottles. 56% of people back then went for 330ml. Only 208 people voted. It's quite an interesting comparison, doing them 3 years apart in terms of a number of things. One, in terms of when we did it the first time, it was all bottles.
Yeah.
Obviously, now the sizes have changed as well. And also shows that in 3 years, how much engagement has grown in the polls that we do on a Sunday evening.
Oh, definitely. But I'd also say a full thing, although the first time it wasn't specifically said bottles, this time it wasn't specifically said cans.
Yeah.
The question and the sizes lent themselves to the vessel.
Absolutely, yeah.
So 330, 500, 660 bottles, quite clearly. That's what we're talking about in 2016. This time we've gone for 330, 440, 500. Definitely cans.
Absolutely.
Without saying cans.
Yeah. And thanks to Ian McGregor at Lateral Mac for just actually suggesting to us.
Let's do it again.
A while ago on Twitter that we should revisit it. So we thought tonight would be the perfect time to do that while we drank our way through
a variety of sizes, actually.
Yeah.
We've gone from a 330 can to, all right, a 473, but let's say a 440 for argument's sake. So we've got varying sizes still to come along.
We have, we've got some American sizings here tonight as well, which again are slightly different. So let's get into some of these comments. Kind of split these up into sections, really, because as always, there's people coming out on either side. So first of all, we had those who are the fans of the 330ml.
Yes.
And I'm going to put my hand up straight away and put myself in this category as well. If I could have voted, this was where my vote would have gone. So Ian McGregor, who suggested the poll, said 330s all the way with a little cheers emoji. Granddad Greg at Greg1954. I'm getting old. 330 mil is easier for me. some great reasons coming out for here. Catherine Wykes at Mrs. Kathy Babes. I'm usually a slow drinker, so a 330 mil works best for me and easier on the waistline, to be honest. Owen Frankish at Evil Brainfish.
I love that. Evil Brainfish.
330 mil, as it gives me the maximum flexibility to drink the amount I want, particularly as I do enjoy the higher ABVs. Plus, it's easier to enjoy the whole thing at the right temperature.
Which sort of comes back to what you were just saying about the other half as well.
Yeah. Simon Clark at Simon Carbon. 330 is my preferred size because if it's a beer I want more of, I have the option to buy a second can. Also, 9% plus beers in 440 and 500 has normalised drinking this much at this strength. No one blinks an eye now, but 10 years ago, the only people regularly doing that would have been people with a problem.
In inverted commas. Yeah.
Breweries need to take some more responsibility. And then the Owl Lady at the Owl Lady. Damn right things have changed, including my answer. With the increased variety of beers to try and the increased average ABV, I far prefer enjoying a few smaller ones and filling up on a hefty 440, 500. Hashtag bring back 330s.
Bring back 330s. So you're definitely in the 330.
I'm definitely in the 330, and I am going to rant at some point about this as
Excellent.
Well.
Excellent. Well, I'm going to drink a bit more before we do that. So the 440 fans, as we're calling them, and we had a few similar comments. So James at Gammon Baron, Justin Mason, your boy Rob Edwards, Ian Hay and Anthony Smith, who's Anthony Smith's kryptonite underscore beer. I like that just because he's got the word kryptonite in there. As I share most of my beers with my wife, it's got to be a 440. So indicating that the 440 is because they're good sharing size.
Yes. Assuming it's just James that's sharing with his wife and not...
No, they're all sharing with James's wife, apparently. James's wife is doing really well off the 440s.
I'm going to jump in there, actually, because you do share the majority of your beers with Michelle,
yes,
don't you?
I do.
So assuming that you're very much leaning towards that, then in terms of 440 is a great size. 440 and above is a great size for sharing.
I have a nuanced answer coming up.
Oh, okay.
But you just have to wait a little while.
Okay.
Chose 440 as a happy medium. It entirely depends on the beer, but I would like to see more 500 milliliter for sessionable beers. Sometimes 440 or 330 isn't enough. And that's from John Moore at The Beer Idiot. Interesting question. I always feel shortchanged with 330 milliliters from the fly at FPL underscore fly. That was it.
Okay.
And then got to be 440. 330 is near enough unless it's an impy stout. You end up having two. 440 is perfect start, perfect size for most styles. And that's from Mr. Ian B at Mr. Underscore Ian underscore B. Always find underscores hard to say.
Yeah.
It's really hard.
And then we've got a whole load of people that sit in the depends camp as well. So we'll go through these and then we'll have our views, I think, before we do some of the other comments. First up, Jan at Mrs. Beer Snob. Sorry, can't choose. Depends on the style of beer, and in this form it's impossible to judge. Now, interestingly...
It's the first time I've heard from one of the beer snobs in ages.
That, and when I went back and looked at the poll from 3 years ago, one of the first comments was from Wayne... saying almost exactly the same thing.
See, Mr. and Mrs. Irish Beer Snob are fully in tune.
Even 3 years apart on their comments. Martin Griffin at Martin Da Monkey. Really depends on ABV. 440 mil for session beers and then 330 mil and perhaps even say smaller at 275 mil for the likes of Imperial Stout and Triple IPAs. J-Dog at Jason Steele 5. Now, J-Dog has sorted this for us. He's got what it should be here.
Yeah, he's got the list.
500 mil up to 5.5%, 440 mil for 5.5 to 7, and 330 mil for over 7%. Cut and dried that, isn't
it? No, but then we have our facts guy.
Oh, yes, Sean O'Reilly and Uncrulia, official number cruncher of the show. Depends on the beer, under 6%, 500 mil, over 6%, 330 mil. Never 440 mil, as there isn't a glass to match it.
And that sparked a little bit of a side conversation about the glassware, didn't it?
It did. We'll come on to that after the next one, because this is also about glassware. Hop Forward at Hop Forward Beers. 440ml is a good size all round, really. I don't mind 330ml, especially on stronger beers, but it'd be nice to have glassware for 330ml that are heavy and shaped like a pint glass, only two-thirds the size. I have seen, and there's something about a pint glass that just feels right. Now, you replied to this one,
I
didn't
you? I did, with a picture.
You did, and you've just got the glass out to visually show our listeners what it looks like.
So listeners, I'm pointing the glass at the microphone now. So this is a glass I picked up when I was in Arizona in 2017, and it probably holds, judging by the time when I put a 330 in here, it probably only holds about 400 millilitres. So the markings on it doesn't really tell you much at all. The marking was on it for a taster pour at a beer festival, so that's all it was for. But it holds a 330 and looks good for a 330. You got the head and a bit of room. So I would say it's probably a 12, American 12 ounce maybe.
Yeah,
it holds.
Probably. Yeah.
That does look good. I do see where that conversation was going, I have to
admit. Yeah, and as you say, it did spark a whole side conversation about glassware.
To be fair, I hadn't thought about the 440 pour not having a glass.
Yeah. Yeah, I think somebody did say that actually the Spieglau glass, the classic IPA glass with the kind of ribbed bottom.
You were trying to find a way of saying two words in a very polite way, weren't you?
Nothing else came apart from the ribbed bottom. Everybody knows what I mean when I say the Spieglau glass. Anyway, apparently that's perfect for a 440ml can.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. And I think the last comment from here off the back of this was from Will Watkins, who, you know, is effectively sponsored tonight's show.
Tonight's show, brought to you by Will Watkins.
So hard to give a universal answer, as it's completely dependent on ABV for me, and to a lesser extent, price. Having more big beers in little sizes would mean I can try more without getting plastered or spending as much.
Well, that's an interesting comment, considering what he sent us.
Yes, yeah. Because, yeah, you didn't consider any of that when you sent us our beers. Thank you very much again. This is why I did vote on the 330. Because 330 is handy. 330 sits in the fridge door better than any other size. 330s fit into cooler bags easier. There's lots of good things about 330s. I think they actually stack better in fridges, that kind of thing. But when we went to Marble 2 months ago, Joe gave us the first beer when we got there. It was their trial number one session IPA, under 4%, ice cold in a 500ml can.
Yeah, because all their cans are 500ml, aren't they?
We downed that.
Nailed it.
Because it was a hot day.
It was a hot day, yeah.
Crisp, clean, loved the 500ml. And I bought some 500ml cans, and I bought plenty of 440s. As sharers, I would probably go, it depends on the beer. There are some beers which me and Michelle share the fanzine beers from Brewdog. They're always 330s. I have now got into a habit. It was a hard habit to get into, of sharing beers. Because now I never used to have to share beers. It was just me and Michael at home. So I'm now used to sharing the beers. So what we tend to do is, for the 330 glass, the 330 beers, we use smaller glasses. So it doesn't look like there's so much space.
Yeah.
And then the glassware will change depending on how big the beer is, as in size of the vessel. And then it always feels like you're still sharing the right sort of level versus the glass. I'm definitely more nuanced. I quite happily have a 500, 4% sessional beer. The beers we like from Half Acre, what are they, 500s or 473s?
I think they're the American 473s.
So the same as the half, other half. And let's face it, we haven't complained about the size of those.
No, that's a very good point, actually.
So I would say 330 is my default, but I can see a place for the 440s and the 500s. But I did like the whole glassware bit.
Yeah, that took it off into a completely different discussion. Now, before we go any further, we have finished the Half Acre
we have
beer. Final thoughts on that?
I know what you're saying about it warming up. And I think if we'd been, if we'd had a can each, ice cold, we probably would have drank it at the same pace as we have sharing one.
Absolutely.
I think we would have enjoyed it maybe a bit more because it would have been ice cold, but I've probably gone more towards the enjoying it than not enjoying it, because I think you've gone the other way.
I really enjoyed it at the start, but as it began to warm, it became more of a challenge to drink. The one thing that I will say about it is that it didn't taste anywhere near 10.5%.
No, it's a dangerous beer.
It's very dangerous. You drink, if we had had a can of that each, things would have been going downhill about now.
Two beers in.
Yeah.
It was really good. What I would say is, it's, again, although it's not my preferred style, and although I started off a bit iffy on it, it felt like the beer was cooked. It looked,
yeah,
felt like
it was finished. Yeah, absolutely.
It wasn't like I was having to store it for a while for it to mature a little bit longer, and I could only have it when someone else said it was finished. It was ready to drink.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I would probably have it again. Wouldn't mind having it cold and draft, maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, don't get me wrong. I can see from that, and I know we've been challenged time and time again by Rob at Hopzine to say, well, you don't diss the murky beers until you've tried the likes of Half Acre and Treehouse and Trillium. I can see the point he's making in terms of the UK's replication of that maybe isn't quite there consistently.
It's not quite as good, but I've now tried two out of three, haven't I? So I've tried the Trillium.
So you're going for the full set, are
yeah,
you?
I'm waiting for Will to send us all the way to try it at Source.
Yeah, so I can see that, absolutely. And yes, I think if we'd had a can each, we probably would have nailed it very quickly.
Although it's summertime, it hasn't necessarily been the best day, but it's quite warm where we're recording, so it has warmed up, I think. I've opened beer number three, and it's
lively.
It is definitely lively. So let's get this into the glass.
Yeah, it's pouring out. So while you're pouring that, I'm going to go through what the third beer is. So this is from Brewery Bosteels, who are a microbrewery in Bougainhout.
Whichever way you say it, whichever way I say it, you know we're going to both get it wrong.
Bougainhout in Belgium.
you sound like the Swedish chef.
Which is actually, if you look at it on a map, it's actually in the middle of a triangle between Brussels, Antwerp and Ghent. It's between those three major places in Belgium. As a brewery, they're best known for Quack, Triple Carmelite and Dais as well. And the brewery's been in the hands of the Bosteels family for over 200 years and seven generations. Their forefather, Everest Bosteels, established the brewery in 1791. And then it came round to their seventh generation, who decided they'd sell the business to ABI in September 2016.
Yeah, I read a big article about them because Triple Carmelite is quite big in the States.
Okay.
Which I didn't know. And I've had Triple Carmelite, but looking at my Untapped, it was obviously before I started on Untapped. And it is considered quite an example of the style of a Belgian triple. But until I'd read the article a year or so back, I had no idea they'd sold to ABI.
No, neither did I until I started reading through it.
Yeah.
So this is a limited release from 2018, single batch BBB01. It's a British style barley wine, coming in at 12.5%. It's a seasonal beer that's been aged in single batch barrels of Madeira.
There's definitely an aroma coming off it. There's a barrel.
I've got none of that so far.
Aged aroma coming over my. But that's mainly because I spilled it over my side.
Okay. Let's. I mean, it's poured very dark, hasn't
it? Yeah.
What's left of it that didn't shoot out the top? Cheers.
There's definitely a bit of a woody.
There is. I mean,
woody nose on there. It doesn't.
That smells like a regional English best bitter.
Can't believe you said that before you tasted it, but it doesn't smell.
That's what the aroma's telling me.
It doesn't smell like a barley wine as I was expecting.
No. Oh, that's soft.
Yeah, I think that carbonation, which was evident when I opened the bottle, has lent itself to be quite soft.
It's got a real soft mouthful, but it's lively at the same time.
Yeah. It's got that. And I've used it before. It's got almost a sort of a bit of a boiled sweet quality to it.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. I'll give
rather
it that.
Than that fruitcake quality, which you sometimes get with barley wine. It's got more of the boiled sweet. Yeah, I think that could grow on me actually.
I think allow that to. Well, I mean, again, we're serving at room temperature.
Yeah.
It's not really going to warm, but just allow it to breathe a little bit in the glass. Just, I suppose, the last thing to say on that, in tune with the other beers we've drunk tonight, the overall worldwide score on Untappd for this one is 3.74. Obviously, all of these Untappd scores that we're talking about are dependent on the number of people that have checked the beer in as well.
Yeah, I mean, I've had Quack before. You've had Quack before, I presume.
Yeah, I did when I was in Belgium recently.
Yeah, so, I mean, for people who aren't too sure, Quack is the one which comes in a like a mini yard of ale in a stand, doesn't it?
Yes, and somebody actually, we'll come on to it later, but somebody actually said that's the bar that takes the shoe one.
Well, yeah. It makes sense because people would be trying to take that. They'll never use it.
Well, if you just wait until Christmas over here, you can get it in any supermarket.
Yeah,
but in a gift pack, I think.
A few years ago, you couldn't.
No.
I think it's a relatively new thing. Looking on my untapped score, although, like most people who've been to Belgium or tried the Quack because it's a good photo opportunity, I've never been that fussed about it. I'm only giving it 3.25. Okay. It's quite low for me for a lot of Belgian beers. And haven't said much about it either. I've just gone 3.25 and Friday night surprise beer in Belgium. That's when I was stuck in Belgium before my brother's wedding in Cologne.
Friday night surprise beer?
Well, yeah, because I was supposed to be in Cologne.
Oh, okay.
That's what
and you were in Belgium.
Me and my brother missed a connection.
At the time. I think the couple of times that I've checked it in, I think I've rated it quite highly, actually. So, first time I checked in Quack was in 2014 on New Year's Eve. And I gave it a 4. And then I checked it in again on Christmas Day in 2017. And I gave it a 3.
So, that's a drop.
That is quite a drop in 3 years. It's
dropped
the whole
mark. 2017 is when you were doing the 12 beers of Christmas. You had a cold then, didn't you?
I did have a cold that year, yeah. Good shout, actually. Maybe I need to revisit it. I know I didn't have it when we recently went to Belgium, but Emma did. She had Quack because she saw the glass and she wanted to do the experience. She didn't have to give up her shoe, though, which for Emma would have been a massive challenge to have given up one of her shoes because she loves her shoes. so that's all I'm going to say about that.
Okay, so no nicking her shoe at the wedding then?
No.
Okay.
Right, so I suppose you want to know my view.
I've given my view.
Yeah.
So you did initially say 330. So are you just 330s or is there a place for others?
I think I'm just, in terms of cans, I think I'm just 330s. And I don't know whether there's some conditioning going on there that canned drinks have always been 330 mils, whether it be soft drinks or you know. And I think when we first started seeing some of the craft beer appearing in cans, it was in 330 mils. Mainstream lagers have always been in the 440, 500 mils, haven't they? We've always had, you know, your Foster's, your Carlin, all the rest
of it. Yeah, Germany's been
in your big cans.
The 440s in the slams, isn't it?
I think what gets my goat, here we go,
okay,
about the 440 mil cans is that every fucking brewery has to put every new beer in a 440 mil can. And it's just tiresome. It's like, oh, God, have some innovation. You know, think about what you're doing. We've spoken before about, particularly about Magic Rock and Human and Unhuman Cannonball. As much as good fun as it is, I don't need 500 mils of Unhuman Cannonball.
Oh, no, it's the wrong way around.
Although I was always quite happy to have 660 mils of it in a bomber. But I don't understand why breweries go up in size with their vessel as the ABV increases. I mean, recently Cloudwater have released a 12% quadruple IPA in a 440ml can. That doesn't need to be in a 440ml can.
No, it's interesting that, because obviously Marble, who we saw a few months ago, they did their barley wine in a 440 can for their 2017. And they brought it down to a 330 can for the 2018.
But that's because they listened to their customers feeding that back, that they didn't need the big cans.
And even me and Michelle shared that the weekend. And again, fine. Smaller glass, sort of end of the session, for want of a better phrase. Yeah. It was a nice size.
Yeah. And I think, I'm still ranting here as well, by the way. I think going back to the whole 440 mil thing, for me, there's something there in terms of me falling slightly out of love with beer in relation to the onset of the 440 ml can, because it happened at the time where everything became juicy and murky and quality control seemed to be an afterthought and costs increased.
I was going to say the last bit, increase the, or sorry, let's put it that way. Definitely my perception of the cost seemed to go up by more than 110 millilitres of beer.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Is that a better way of putting it?
Yeah.
So, you know, what I had in my head of a 330 can, when it became a 440, the cost seemed to go up more than...
The cost seemed to double rather than to...
Rather than an extra third, so yeah. To speak. And I found that quite hard to work with. And if you ordered a few, and I have, mounts up. Becomes quite a big cost.
And you're taking a risk as well. Well, sometimes.
Especially if it's either a new beer or new beer from a new brewery. So there are some breweries who, we've said it before, with trust.
Yeah.
So there are some breweries who bring out 440s. I may not go for them, but if I did, I'm probably fairly confident it's still going to be good. But a 440 from a new brewery, it may be 7 or 8 quid. Cut a couple of those in your cut. Suddenly you're doing 16, 17 quid for two drinks.
Yeah, it becomes really expensive.
Yeah, and for some, this becomes prohibitive for some people.
And I've had my fair share of beers that haven't been good as well, and I've spent a lot of money on them, and I'm like, and now I'm wasting 440 mils of beer. Now that's a lot of liquid I'm wasting there.
Yeah.
Because I'm not enjoying this beer, and I for one, I love when you see the likes of is it Salt Brewing, Salt Beer yeah. Factory, who are new in Salt Air, just released cans. First time they've released cans, they're all 330 mil, well, which is great.
And Siren recently.
Siren.
Done their, announced. Could be classed as their, part of their core range.
Yeah.
Have done four lots of cans, even including their breakfast stout.
Yeah, but also, they've also said, so this was kind of, this was last week, wasn't it? So they've got a really smart new rebrand. And news about their cans.
I think
as
the
well.
Cans look really good.
Their cans look great, and you know it's Siren.
You can see the branding.
Yeah. So they've said they're going to can both 330 and 440 mil, with 440 mil being introduced over the next couple of months. Flagship will be in 330 mil. One-off seasonal and collaborative releases will be labelled and packed into 330 or 440 at our discretion. We're conscious of the price points that come with the larger formats and appreciate that some styles are better suited than others. It's like Siren have gone, we're listening. We've listened to what craft beer have said about can size.
What's their last sentence?
And appreciate that some styles are better suited than others.
And
choice is good.
Choice is good.
Yeah.
So they're going to give us a choice, or it will be at their discretion. They're still going to take a think about it. So yeah. That's what you said. It's not everything's 440, not everything's 330. We're going to have a bit of think about it, maybe ask a few people, maybe see how other ones have gone of a similar type of beer, and then we'll decide how we're going to package it.
Yeah.
They probably won't get it right every time.
No, absolutely not. And they'll probably have people saying, oh, why didn't you just go straight into 440? Because that's what craft beer expects now is 440 mil cans.
Surely if you've got... Talking about the cans, I don't even know if you finished your rant yet, but still.
I might just be halfway through.
But, you know, listeners might be quite glad I'm interrupting them for a second. But surely in not just your fridge at home, but fridges in shops, maybe more so than bars, the 330 stack better.
Yeah, you can get two on a shelf.
Yeah.
Normally.
So if you want to keep them all cold, which everyone wants cold beers generally, you can have more there. Whereas the 440s, it always feels like there's space above.
Yeah.
Maybe in bars you want 440s sometimes because they stand out a bit more because of the real estate of the can and apparently some sticky thing behind it as well sometimes. But yeah, I would say that the 330s generally hit a bit of a sweet spot for me still.
I would never buy a 440 mil can from a bar for fear of how much it's going to cost.
Versus whether you like it or not.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, like I say, I'm at a point where if I see another new brewery launch with 440 mil cans, I'm not going to be held responsible for my actions.
Okay, you heard it here, and I have to see him quite regularly, so please think Steve.
But equally, recently, Buxton have dropped back down to 330 mils.
Yep. And they were big advocates of the 440s.
They were. And a lot of people said, oh, well, you're clearly going into supermarkets. And they were like, no, we're just trying it to see if it's a better size for our cans.
Well, Axe Edge was always 330 bottle.
Yeah. I love Axe Edge, but I don't need 440 mils of it in one go.
No.
One of the comments earlier was about the beer warming up.
Yeah. You don't want Exeter warming up.
Yeah, yeah. And Simon's comment about, well, if I like it, I can buy another one.
Or you've already got another one, you can decide whether to have it or not.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm still very, very happy with Cannonball in a 330ml can. I'm ecstatic with Jaipur in a 330ml can. I don't need them in 440ml cans just to keep up with the Joneses.
But I will still go back to my original. I think there's a lot of good reasons for the 330 cans. I agree with you. I'm not sure new breweries producing new beers should be diving in on 440 cans when they come out as expensive as they can do.
Yeah, prove yourself.
Yeah.
Prove yourself in a 330.
Yeah.
And if your beer's good, then I'm more than happy for you to put it in a 440 mil.
440 straight away, £6-7 a can, you're taking a risk and I'm taking a risk.
Yeah.
But I would say there are certain beers, and I go back to that example, or the Session IPA where it had it marble, 500ml can, we smashed that.
We did smash that. And when I've had cans of, you know, how to call it, pint, metric.
Yeah.
I've smashed that.
Yeah.
As well in 500 mils. And a few people did also mention about Arbor and their 568 pint cans.
And when we were up in Bristol in Christmas for the pre-Crimbo crawl, which is now a thing, we were sharing those around. And that, they were perfect for that evening. Would I buy a case of 568 milliliter cans? Probably not.
Yeah. And also, still going, as a train beer, I'm more comfortable sitting and drinking a 330 mil on a train than I am maybe a bigger can, because it kind of, when you've got a larger can in your hands, it you start getting those connotations of, oh, it's the drunk in the corner drinking a big can of beer, whereas with a smaller can, it's much easier to drink on the train. And
I've never thought about that. I used to have the 568 M&S Citroen in bottles. That was way bigger than a can. But then I was on the InterCity, which had a table.
And also had Ghost Ship available at the bar on the...
Oh, yeah, there is that as well. I'm going to cry now.
On the train.
I don't have either of those things.
Yeah. So let's dive back into some more comments. And the next series of comments is all about what we've just been chatting about, which is the cost of them as well. So first up from Riverman Brews, Riverman Brews UK. Not enough that they actually forced their way onto actually guesting on the show. They still want to be involved.
They still want to get mentioned, don't they?
In the spirit of the poll, voted 330, but it still absolutely depends on the strength of the beer, and it assumes a direct relationship between size and cost, which is what you were saying earlier. Gregor at Gregor_J_, 330ml generally. However, I think beer style should be considered when packaging beer. The 500ml bottles that Kernel use for their pale ales are an absolute treat, which I love. I think big cans of Dipper are also too expensive. Bay Beer Reviews at Bay Beer Review says, I voted 330 because it lets you have a wider variety of different beer if that's your thing. The advent of 440 mils as the norm seems to have coincided with the £7, £8, £9 rip-off can of beer. Plus 440s reminds me of Dross Lager of yesteryear.
Similar to what you were saying.
Yeah.
Put you in mind of the going to the supermarket, buying a slab of beer, 440 can.
And just drinking it, yeah. Michael at Mick McGrority, got to be 330 purely on price. 440s always seem to end up £4 plus, which pushes them into special purchase territory for me. That extra £1 a can will add up if everybody is doing 440s. And finally, Wemden Beer Monster at Barley Wine is Life, 330 mils so I can try more beers. Voted the same in 2016. I also object to the increasing number of £7 plus 440ml cans, which must be overlooked by many of those on a budget.
I think it's a valid point. Cost comes into it.
Yeah.
We all have varying budgets. We all have varying things we need to spend it on. You know, there's a lot of essentials we need to spend it on. And let's be honest, 440ml cans of beer can never be, or any sort of beer can never be decided as an essential or, you know, classified as essential. So when they start becoming, you know, so Michael has said £4 plus, Baby Review said £7, £8, £9, and Webden has said £7 plus. These are now the norm for 440ml cans.
That's a lot of money to spend on...
Well, if you do an online order, and you're going for 12 of that, that's an expensive beer order.
Absolutely.
For beers which, for some of them, you may not I've tried before.
But if you also factor in Gregor's comments there as well about Colonel using 500ml bottles for their pale ales, absolutely yes, and I love that. But I'm not paying more than £4 or £5 for 500ml of Colonel beer.
Colonel beers, aside from some of the places I have purchased it in London on draft, bottle-wise, whether you're doing it direct, but turning up at Colonel, doing it, say, through Ibria, I've always found the prices to be quite reasonable.
Really reasonable.
Regardless of the size.
It'll be interesting if Colonel ever went into cans, how much and what size.
Do you reckon that'll ever happen?
I hope not. Honestly, if that happens, listeners, you can hold me to this. If that happens, I'm done with beer.
Oh, God.
I am actually done with beer. If Colonel ever go into a 440 wraparound fucking label, honestly.
God, Tuesday morning, Colonel drops the news. 440 cans with a brown paper bag around it.
Right, yeah. Full rip-off lid as well. That would just finish it off for me.
So we had a few other views as well. So from That Beer Place at That Beer Place HQ. We've seen a distinct shift away from customers buying craft in 330, especially in bottles. 500ml bottle just seemed to scream trad. I think that's probably fair enough. Most people.
Absolutely.
Although North Riding Brew still do 500ml bottles.
And as we just said, Colonel still do.
So there are a few exceptions, but I would agree the 500 does.
Do you remember when Thornbridge used to do 500ml?
Of Jaipur.
Yeah, it already feels like forever ago, doesn't it?
Yeah. So that leaves 440 as the people's choice. Oddly, package size, carry on here, seems to outweigh the quality inside for many consumers.
That's really interesting, isn't
it? That's an interesting one.
That final part of that comment.
Yeah, so distinct shift away from the 330s, especially in bottles. Yeah, we've seen bottles are sort of disappearing.
Yeah.
500 bottles, generally people would assume that's a trad beer or trad beer trying to do craft. 440, I can see. 440 is almost like Uber craft now.
It's almost to the point where if you're not doing 440, you're not craft.
Yeah. You're just main. So if you're doing 330s, you must be going into supermarkets. That's the only reason you do 330s.
Yes, because that was one of the first things that somebody said about Siren's announcement. They went, oh, you must be going into supermarkets if you're doing 330.
Yeah, which wasn't the case.
No.
It was never the case because part of their crowdfunding pitch about
cans. Yeah.
That was one of their aims, wasn't it? And they've obviously taken their time to do it. So that's a really interesting comment there. From Stephen Hadfield at Saddest of Fields. Funny thing is, I'm usually bored of the contents of my 440s after 330ml. I find the more interesting beers coming out of 330s or 500s, regardless of being trad or not. That's quite an interesting comment. And lastly, penultimately, from Hopzine at Hopzine, was the 440ml can made popular because US hype breweries like Trillium and Treehouse were using them? They were adopted by UK breweries that wanted to benefit from the reflected similarities to those US producers?
Possibly.
What do you think?
Well, I mean, if you look at that can that we've had this evening, it's a silver can with a wraparound label. So it's I think if we look at the early adopters of the 440ml cans being Cloudwater, that was very similar to what their early cans looked like as well.
Yeah, that's true.
And almost the same now as well, you know, most Cloudwater cans have still got a wraparound label on a plain silver can underneath it.
Yeah, I'd agree with that, but I hadn't thought about them sort of mirroring.
No, but we know Cloudwater have taken massive inspiration from the likes of Trillium and Treehouse in terms of the way they've gone about beer production and, you know, publicity and everything. You know, that's there for them, isn't it?
Before we do the last comment, which is obviously very extensive, from Mark N. Johnson, apparently co-host of the show, final thoughts on the beer?
I really enjoyed that. As it sat in the glass for a little bit longer, the liveliness died down a little bit and it really rounded out and became really soft on the finish. had a really sweet, and I started to get some of those fruitcake flavours coming through that you do get from a traditional English barley wine.
Okay, so I started to like it less.
It's really interesting.
As it warmed up, I actually preferred it when it was a bit cooler and had more of that carbonated board sweet. Almost like a fizzy board sweet. You know, inside the board sweet sometimes has that fizzy bit.
Yeah.
That's what it reminded me of. Whereas as it warmed up and got a bit sweeter, a little bit more cloying, I wasn't loving it quite as much.
That's really interesting that we seem to be shifting on all of the beers in terms of our starting point and our finishing point. Probably not so with this next one.
No, I think this one might be a bit more aligned.
I'm, out of the five beers we were given, this is the one I'm most excited about trying, and it's not just because it's 18%.
So, last comment from, as the aforementioned co-host, from Mark N. Johnson, simply put, 440 millilitres, bottles. Thanks, Mark.
Which I thought was brilliant.
Had to actually be different.
Yeah. I think I actually replied to that, and it's very rare that I reply to comments that are made, and I simply said to him, what with wraparound labels?
Yeah. So I have now poured the fourth beer from this wonderful selection that's been sent to us by Will.
Yeah, and this is, like I say, this is the one I am most excited about, I've got to say.
So the reason you're excited about this, Steve, is because it's a Imperial India Pale Ale. It's the Dogfish Head 120 Minute IPA, as it's called. And it comes in at a sessionable 18%, I believe. And on the front of it, it says age as well. Now, we're not sure when this was bottled, are we?
No, I did ask Will, and he said he had no idea when he picked it up. I mean, it is, like I say, it says age as well, but then on the side, it says drink fresh or leave for 10 years. There's no middle ground there, no. Really, is
so
there?
So we don't know where we're sitting on this?
No, absolutely not.
Now, have you had the 90 minute?
I've had the 90 minute and I've had the 60 minute as well, both when I was in the States on holiday.
Oh, when you went to Florida?
Yeah.
I haven't had the 60
minute. Both found in the supermarket on the shelf, which I was like a kid in a candy shop.
Okay, well, I'm going to, and I may have mentioned it before, I might try and trump that, because the 90 minute Imperial IPA was available on the Amtrak.
Yes, yeah, you told me that.
Train beer.
Yeah.
90 minute Imperial IPA.
So the thing with all of these beers is that the amount of time indicates how long it's been continuously hopped for. So that's every minute hops are added to the boil.
Okay, so 60 minutes is literal.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
Should we get into it?
Let's get into it, and let's not let it warm too much. Cheers.
That has just got that that's got an IPA nose, hasn't it, still?
Yeah, I mean the one thing that this beer advertises itself as is the holy grail for hop heads.
Oh. That initial tasting is fantastic.
Oh.
But just to be clear, that's the only bit I tasted, there's no way I could say that was 18%.
No, but I think in a few sips we'll be saying, yeah, that's 18%. Yeah.
Look out, listeners.
Yeah, so I've had both the 60 and the 90.
So what did you... I mean, I gave 4 out of 5 for the 90 minute. Like I said, I had no idea
I gave both of them 4 out of 5.
I haven't had the 60. I also had, and I think this was from you, the Flesh and Blood.
Yes, it was. That was some of the ones I bought back from when I was in Florida.
And again, bags of fruit, really nice, juicy. And I mean juicy as in the flavour rather than the like the gloopy kind of juices from 2016. Really enjoyed it. You got all that fresh orange coming through, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. So some stuff about the beer. As I say, it's continuously hopped with copious amounts of high alpha US hops throughout the boil and whirlpool, and then dry hopped with another palette of hops afterwards. It's unfiltered as well. 18% Imperial IPA, but if you leave it to age, it does, by all accounts, turn into the most amazing barley wine. From Dogfish Head, who are based in Delaware in the States, originally opened in 1995 by Sam Calaglione, produces 262,000 US barrels annually. Their first beer was called Midas Touch, which was brewed with honey, white muscat grapes and saffron, which is something quite different from
that's an ambitious start, isn't it?
Yeah, for a first beer. Although they originally started by only selling beer in the state of Delaware, Dogfish Head is soon became one of the most profitable microbreweries in the states. As of 2017, it distributes beer to 38 states. In 2018, Dogfish Head had become one of America's largest and most well-known breweries, producing around 15,000 gallons of beer per day. And then as we recently on the news,
I think we referenced this.
Dogfish Head were acquired by the Boston Beer Company for $300 million.
And they're the ones who make Sam and Adams Boston Lager.
Yeah, so, and I think we said at the time, if that means we see more Dogfish Head in the UK, that's a great thing. I mean, this beer I would love to see here.
Well, this is 19%. I thought I'd done their biggest beer when I went to Arizona. Their oak-aged vanilla worldwide stout, which came in at a measly 17.5. I didn't know they had a beer bigger than this. They do some massive beer. I mean, this is completely out of kilter with what Boston Sam Adams do.
Yeah.
Even with some of the Sam Adams specials, they don't do this sort of crazy stuff.
No, but that's why the partnership was formed, because these do the out there stuff and Boston do the straight up stuff you want to drink.
And also different parts of the country, I presume, as well.
Yeah.
So you've got Delaware, you've got Boston. There's quite a range of places that are going to be to cover. And if they've already got access to 38 states, you're going to start to cover most of the US, aren't you?
Absolutely.
And they've probably seen what happened with a few other breweries who tried to expand on their own. Probably a good move.
Yeah.
This is fantastic.
I mean, that finish, it's like resinous multiplied, and then you just get this bitterness that just cuts through everything. It's citrus, it's caramel,
it's got those piney resinous notes that brought us into the IPAs.
It's in the most basic sense, assuming that possibly most of our listeners will maybe never get the opportunity to try this beer, imagine taking Sierra Nevada Pale Ale and timesing everything about it by 10. No, probably.
This is like the Bugatti Veyron.
This is, you're getting close to what this is in terms of its flavour, its mouthfeel, the body, the finish, everything about it. It's just incredible.
But how have they made this beer at 18% and this drinkable?
I've no idea. And apparently the ABV varies each year because it's one of these beers that's produced annually.
Oh, what, between 17 and 19 then?
Yeah. Why not? Why not?
They don't actually advertise on the bottle.
No. The bottle's very very scarce in information.
Very scarce in detail.
Isn't it? Were we done with Hopinions? Did we finish off there with Mark's comment? Okay. Yeah. So just to say, as always, if you want to read all of the comments, and there were a lot of comments on this
week's
poll.
There was easily, between 70 and 80 comments.
Yeah, we couldn't feature them all, but there is a link in the show notes to the original question. Click on that, you'll be able to read all of the answers if you so desire. And if you want to still carry on getting involved in the discussion, use the hashtag opinions, and you may very well feature in this next part of the show.
Let us know. Write it down. Let us know. Write it down. Let us know your thoughts and bitter in lingerness. Write it down.
Quite a lot of feedback again on some recent shows. First up from Top Rope Brewing at Top Rope Brewing. Lovely to have a mention on the Beer O'Clock Show. Hope you enjoyed the beer and the city. I had a check-in at the brewery. I had a check at the brewery earlier, and that was the last bottle that you guys drank. Give us a shout next time you're up, and we'll come say hi.
So this was the beer that Rob Beer Odyssey bought us, wasn't it?
It was.
Dead crafty. Again, thank you very much, Rob. I know you're not currently on Twitter, but I hope you're still listening to the show. That was a fantastic beer.
It was amazing, and even better to now know it was the last beer in existence.
But still, weirdly, it was the last beer in existence, but it was number one.
Yes, yeah.
It's quite strange, that one, but yeah. I quite like the symmetry to that.
But I think we need to go back to Liverpool to do something with Top Rope Brewing so we can do wrestling and beer.
Yes, you can.
Can I sub someone in for that show?
Yes,
can I take Chinnery with me?
Yes, you take Chinnery, I'll be at Anfield.
Okay. Well, you can maybe sub me out and then we could do a football, wrestling...
Well, Chinnery can do both sides.
Yeah. Yeah, Chinnery would be the only main host that weekend. Will Watkins at Dry Your Beers. So, again, once again, Will, we can't thank you enough for these beers, especially having now tasted the Dogfish Head 120-minute IPA. Will said, cheers for another shout-out, gents. Have to say I agree with Martin. Preferred the Cloudwater West Coast Pale versus the IPA, which shocked me. Please tell me you're recording the next pod on a Monday night, 18%... Clearly we are, Will.
Yep. And also, he's got such great taste because he agreed with me.
Well, you're both wrong.
Oh, he's another one who's wrong, is he?
You're both wrong, yeah. Beers Without Frontiers podcast at beers_frontiers. Great show again, guys. Despite some challenging acoustics, air conditioning noises. Really sorry about that in the last show. Sometimes you don't hear these things until you go back into the edit. Yeah. Always nice to hear brown ales discussed. Recently had a great American brown ale at Drink More Beer Tap in Bermondsey. It's a great style, but I feel it's filed alongside mild as being uncool. What do you think about that?
I think it's probably right, actually, because I think we mentioned that, and I said that the American brown ale is such a great example of the brown ale style, whereas over here with the twiggy hedgerow version of that.
From Richard Taylor at RichTaylor1608, I'm predicting more root vegetable beers. I've seen a few carrot beers and beetroot beers recently. Definitely not for me, but they exist. Another great show. Looking forward to future shows. I'm going to say straight away, none of those beers are for me.
I don't want
vegetable in my beer.
I think I've had a beetroot beer before. I don't need to rush back to root vegetable beers at all. From Hopzine, second comment from Hopzine.
He's doing well, yeah.
I do like a brown ale, non-Nuki. My predictions, more IPAs. Well, thanks, Hopzine. Thanks, Rob.
I think that's a given, isn't it? Yeah. That we're going to see more IPAs.
From River and Brews, at River and Brews UK. You may have heard about them before.
Their second comment. I know. What's going on?
For those of you that heard us discussing beers made with Kvik.
Vike.
On the last Opinions podcast, here's a great little article that tells you more than any of us knew when we recorded, and there'll be a link to the show note, link through the show notes to that one
yes.
as well.
Yes, yeah, because we found some bits after we had recorded that show.
And actually, I saw in the Pelt Trader the other day, there was a beer from Siren which had the same, it's a yeast strain, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Same yeast strain had been used in it. I took a picture of that to send to them, so that was quite interesting actually. Something I'm going to see everywhere.
I think it's one of those things that you're going to suddenly see everywhere. Yeah. From Neil Hayden at Neil Hayden 73. I'm not sure of the bar, however, I think the shoe deposit you mentioned on the show relates to quack as you get a glass and a stand.
Which is what we mentioned earlier. It makes sense, but it's the obvious one to go for, isn't it?
Yeah. Mark Johnson, again, at Marking Johnson. Finally got round to this. Most enjoyable, Andrew and Luke. They should start their own podcast. Stephen Martin were right too, I guess. In reference to the thief of eight glasses... I like the way he capitalised all of that as well. He did wear a huge coat with innumerable pockets. I think there were four glasses in each pocket and two up the sleeves. He was a skinny lad too, so it looked rather obvious. I've spent enough in there in the 13 years since to not feel too guilty though. And also just some other feedback we've had. It wasn't via Twitter, but obviously we do listen to other beer podcasts and we know
other
beer
podcasts. Well, I'm not going to anymore because they just reference our guests.
Listen to us, yeah. We did get some nice feedback from Men Behaving Badly about the episode that we did with Mark Johnson, although they did only seem to think that Mark was the expert in the room.
I've decided in my own head that they're actually complimenting us because a bit like the best... interviewers of our day, Wogan, Aspel, Parkinson, they made their guests so at ease that you got everything from them.
Yeah.
So because we get our guests on, they become part of the show, we get everything from them. So I'm going to take that as a compliment for us.
Okay, we'll take that one. I did particularly enjoy their last show though, where they were doing a flight of beers in the beer garden.
It was the four different beers, wasn't it?
Yeah, and someone randomly came up and started speaking to them, and they had the conversation in the middle of the podcast. Yeah. No need to cut that sort of stuff out, guys. Just leave it in.
It's too much like hard work. Yeah, just leave it where it is.
Absolutely. And I think that's it for feedback. We've just got the one question to do, but
before we get into the question,
because we've still got another beer,
which will obviously see us out of the show.
Yeah.
So Final thoughts on Dogfish Head 120 minute IPA.
Well, you give yours. Why I finished mine?
Because I finished mine.
Yeah.
Bloody amazing! I remember how I felt when I was drinking the 90 minute one on the train. First of all, thinking, how on earth is this so accessible on the train? And why are you selling it to me on a train at 9:30 in the morning? This is just so easy to drink.
It is, but that bitterness goes on for days, yes. And I love it.
It's brilliant.
I absolutely love it. I mean, this is what made me fall in love with beer.
Mm.
And over the last couple of years, there's been no secret. I've fallen out of love with beer a little bit because everything's become juicy and hazy. Somebody in the UK needs to produce something like this.
Do you reckon they can?
I don't know if they can. I think all they can produce right now is juice bombs.
Because, you know, like I said, you've had the 60 minute, I've had the 90, we've now had the 120. We're both big fans of the 120.
I love the 120.
Could I tell? If I was doing a blind tasting, there's no way I'd pitch that 18%.
Oh, I don't know. I think if you were doing a bottle of that to yourself, by the time you got to the end of it, because it's only a 330ml bottle.
Maybe a bottle, but...
Is that a 330ml?
But a blind tasting, you wouldn't be doing a bottle.
Is it a bit more than a 330?
But you wouldn't be doing a bottle.
No, that's true, but picture yourself with a bottle of that on your own.
Well...
By the time you started getting to the end of it, you'd know you'd been drinking.
Well, if that had been the option on the train, Michael would have been getting off the train. I'm staying right through to Washington, Philadelphia.
And then I'm coming back again.
Yeah, drinking the same shit again. Question.
Questions fill my head. This is from Ian Hay at II Hay. Bloke in the airport lounge drinking champagne and eating soup. Not a good combo in my honest opinion. Cheese and beer for me. What's the oddest food and drink pairing you've seen?
I'm going to ask a different question. Can you eat soup? Do you slurp soup or drink soup or eat soup?
I think you drink soup. I think it's normally part of a menu, isn't it? So you do eat soup.
Because I always associate eating with like chewing.
Well, you could ask the same question of ice cream then, couldn't you?
Yeah.
Do you eat ice cream?
Yeah. I would ask the same question.
Okay, this is a whole new podcast that we're going into.
Is that another spin-off?
Yeah.
Okay.
Opinions on eating.
Eating habits.
Yeah.
Right, okay. Before we answer... We have Wicked Weed Brewing.
Is this giving us time to think about it then?
Think about the answer. Okay. So it's all time. It's all planned. Yep. Barrel aged El Paraiso or Paraiso Imperial Coffee Stout brewed with coffee and cocoa nibs. And I think this one dropped down to a much more sensible 11.5%. So we've just knocked 6.5% off the beer.
Yeah, we did go high. It was always a question of whether we did the Dogfish Head at the end.
Yeah, but it always feels right to finish on the barrel-aged stout, doesn't it?
It does. So, as you say, barrel-aged imperial stout, 11.5%. Wicked Weed are from Asheville in North Carolina in the States, founded in 2012. But announced in 2017 that they've been acquired by ABIn Bev. The second of the breweries are featured tonight.
So that's 2 out of 5.
Yep.
Two of the news items were ABI related. Yep.
They were, and I don't think anyone will disagree with me for saying this, they were very much the craft darlings in the States, and they were dropped like a hot brick the minute they sold to ABIn Bev.
I think it was similar to some of the noise over here about, say, Beavertown.
Yeah, if you thought the outrage over here for Beavertown was bad, you should have seen what went on when these guys announced that they'd sold. But yeah, as you say, barrel-aged, bourbon barrel-aged. Let's see what we've got. Cheers. I mean, that's just all coffee.
That is.
On the nose.
Bags of coffee on the nose. I was expecting maybe a bit of bourbon or vanilla or something.
Yeah, I'm getting none of that. I am just getting almost 100% coffee.
Okay, pretty much coffee now as well, on the flavour, on the palate.
Oh, you know what? I'm a little bit disappointed. That's really thin.
Yeah, but hold on. We've gone, think about the beers we've just had.
I know, but now I'm thinking we should have done the Dogfish Head last.
No. We need to build into it. Build into it. Okay. Remember, we've had a bit of advice from people, some listeners like Justin in the past. Yeah. You need a bit of a palate reset. We've got enough beer in the glass to palate reset. Have you had beers from Wicked Weed before?
No, these are, along with Amundsen, they're the only two. No, I've had them, other half, and these guys I haven't had before.
Okay, well, I have, but bizarrely, not when I was in the States.
Oh, okay.
When I went to the Netherlands last.
Oh.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So when I went out for a bit of a bike ride, because it was, I think May time, I went out the last time. One of these bars, which I already popped on to before, stopped off, and I had a couple of their IPAs. So I had one called Freak of Nature.
Okay.
IPA Imperial / Double, according to Untappd. I've given it 4.25, and I've just gone waves of piney bitter goodness. And it does look good on the picture.
It does look really good, actually.
And then I followed that up by having just their IPA called Lieutenant Dank.
I have had beers. I've had this beer.
There you go.
I've had Lieutenant Dank.
And I give that a 4, and I've gone exactly as hopped for.
Oh, you know, now you say it, I was, you remember that last Christmas Miles did that Beery Secret Centre?
Yeah.
Somebody sent me some Wicked Weed beers as part of that.
Oh, cool.
So I'm just...
just looking on Untappd?
Yeah, just seeing one beer, the Lieutenant Dank. Which...
No, you only give 3.5.
Piney bitterness laced with sharp citrus and subtle tropical notes, 3.5. That was one of a 3-beer session that I did as part of a single day on the 12 beers of Christmas last year.
Okay.
So that might have affected my rating.
True, but I did think both the IPAs I had were very good. This, I still think it's tasting really nice. I just think we just need to get into it a little bit more.
Yeah, I've got to agree. We've followed on from, I'm going to say... 4 fairly thick beers in terms of their body. Even the barley wine had a certain thickness to it.
Definitely got thicker as it went on.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see how this one goes.
So back to the question, right? So from Ian Hay at II Hay, bloke in the airport, champagne and soup. What's the weirdest combination you've had, or oddest combination, or one you've seen?
So I'm not a big foodie, so I don't really go in for the whole food and beer matching. So I'm not sure I've got one for this.
Okay, I have.
Okay.
I always found it really weird, and I'm going to count you in this as well, when we'd have the bottle share, where you'd bring along chocolate brownies to just share out with random beers. I do not get sweet stuff and beer.
No.
Even with a sweet beer.
See, I think it works.
No. When I'm drinking beer, I'm about the beer, unless we've got, say, meat or cheese, or something unhealthy like pork scratchings. I do not need sweet stuff with beer. The two things don't go together for
me. Not even if it's with the beer that the brownies have been made.
Oh, even more so. If you give me a brownie now which was made with this barrel-aged beer, I'll be going, oh, God, no.
No way I'd put this beer in a brownie.
But
that would be wasteful.
I know, but concept, you see what I say?
Yeah.
It's just a sweet with sweet. Too much sugar going
on. I mean, I have been to, and it felt fairly odd at the time. Oh, a good few years back now, I went to an event that was, Harveston ran an event that was their Ola Do series, and they had paired them with cheese and chocolate. And that still, even to this day, feels quite strange, doing beer, cheese and chocolate. For me, it would have been beer and chocolate or beer and cheese. The cheese and chocolate don't necessarily work together.
No.
For me.
Don't work for me. I would go cheese.
Okay.
Okay.
So it's an interesting question to finish on.
But,
and it's one that I'm going to throw that one back to our listeners as well. Tell us what your strangest food and drink combinations, pairings have been. Use the hashtag feedback.
Yeah, we want to know both sides of it. We want to know the food and the drink.
Absolutely, yeah. Some more thoughts on the beer then. So we've been slowly enjoying this while we've been thinking about that question.
I'm still glad this is the last beer. I reckon it would have been a struggle to follow up on this one. Not because there's anything wrong with the beer, because it is starting to grow on me as a end of evening beer.
It is. If I was to look at the beers again, in hindsight of having tasted them, I maybe would have put the Desert in a can at the end, just because of the flavours and the sweetness and the thickness of it. Once again, massive thanks to Will for sending these to us.
Yeah, and I can't say enough. I was when Steve sent me the picture and sent me the message which came with it, I was blown away.
Yeah, I was when I opened it.
Completely blown away. You know, literally just saying thanks. And I have no desire for other people to send this for that reason, but thank you ever so much, Will. Means a lot.
Absolutely. And to have got to try the holy grail of beer for hopheads.
Oh.
The Dogfish Head.
Yes. Probably my beer of the year now.
Well, it's going to be a hard one to beat, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's be honest. If you want to get involved in the show, use the hashtag Hopinions and we will find you and shout you out probably on the next show, which at this stage, we have no idea what we're doing next, do we?
No, we have no idea. So
it's 2 weeks away.
In between, I'm sort of focused on getting married.
There's something big going on in the middle.
Yeah.
So.
And we might record a show for later on in the year.
Yeah.
But the actual next studio-bound show, no fixed title, no fixed theme.
How about this? Let's throw it out to the listeners.
No.
Yes. What do you want us to talk about?
Oh,
not beer wise. We'll sort the beers.
Right.
But what do you want us to talk about on the next show? Listener choice.
That's it. Literally, listener choice.
Choice.
All right. But say there's so many choices. How do we pick?
Well, we'll put them in a hat or something. Or choose the one that we feel we can get most conversation out of.
Okay. All right. Well, you heard it here. It's down to you guys. So
we're all about the listeners. We're all about the engagement.
It's either going to be an hour-long show or a three-hour show. It's down to you.
You tell us what you want us to talk about on the show.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yeah. So, it's been a great evening.
Yeah.
Once again, mate, I hope everything goes well at the weekend.
Thank you very much.
I'm sure it will. And all the very best for the future.
See you at the wedding, Steve.
Cheers.
Cheers. I'm building up my problem to the size of